Then the other issue, if we get past that argument, then we are going to have to reconsider the slap statute because it's no longer the law. It was repealed in July 2016, so we need to analyze the case under the new law.
And last, do you want your proactivity counsel to be present for the next hearing that we have?
No, if I'm more concerned with getting it scheduled quickly than whether or not it'll be.
All right, how long do you need to respond to her motion?
Having only briefly reviewed it, I think we'll need at least a couple of weeks to.
All right, today's October 28th. What do we have towards the end of November? Why don't y'all walk back to Krista and get a date, and then we'll prepare a little order. You tell Krista, she'll type it up saying all motions are to be heard on such and such day. And so there won't be any confusion. I don't mind you saying the defendant's motion to dismiss under whatever.
Right.
Defendant's second motion to dismiss on.
We have two motions to dismiss.
To the dismiss. One is under jurisdictional, and a motion to dismiss, what's the second?
Anti-slap.
On the anti-slap.
Correct.
Slap meaning strategic lawsuit against public participation. Strategic lawsuit against public participation. That's what slap means. Right. Y'all want to gather all your goodies?
Sure, Your Honor, if you can excuse the veterinarian here.
Sure. Doctor, you're
so you
good.
Better.
Thank you for coming.
It's nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
I don't know.
Dress the court, did Judge Grubbs was in her courtroom with shorts on. Did you know that? You can't wear shorts in her courtroom.
Okay. He'll take off that now. She can go with you.
Who is that?
Oh, that's the defendant.
Right.
Okay, yeah, you better shut that.
All right, so done that. They're coming back from that. And I think Carrie Fowler and Lori Fowler are coming back. So that's all. Deborah Michael or Lisa Mikowski. Okay. So the last running man is NRA LR Barnes LLC. So y'all want to come get set up. And let's see, Mr. Mayor, did you decide y'all want to take it down?
Yes, Your Honor, we'll accept the cost and handle it.
Okay.
Of course, out of the caller and seller, but you do want to take it down.
Thank you.
NRA LR Barnes LLC, doing business as Four Seasons Auction Gallery of Forsyth, civil action file number 16-1-2093. And we're here to decide what's to be done with the rest of the money that's being held by the receiver, Mr. Terry Phillips. And he's represented by Michelle Wilson. And Ms. Wilson, I think the last hearing we had resulted in an order that I signed September the 12th, but wasn't filed until September 16th of 2016. That's right.
Correct.
Correct. All right. So we're here today, and the receiver, Mr. Phillips, has told us there's very limited resources available. So, Ms. Wilson, on behalf of the receiver, y'all do not wish to share the takedown of this proceeding.
That's correct.
All right. So you're, but Mr. Richard Merritt, who represents, I think I saw that you represented three claimants, Pamela Michael, Robert White, and Donnie Millsaps.
There are actually two more that have joined since I filed your
own. That's fine.
And I'll put that on the record at the appropriate time.
So there's five of them, and you do wish to have the case reported, and your clients and you will be responsible for the takedown cost.
Yes, Your Honor.
Thank you so much. And you've explained to them that taking it down does not generate a transcript. There's an additional fee. I think it's a $3.78 a page.
Yes, sir.
So if it's a two-hour hearing for at $3.78, how long is that going to be?
About 60 pages per hour.
60 pages per hour. So we'll say it's times 2 hours. That'd be 120 pages, 3.78. So that would be an additional $453 if you order a transcript.
Understood.
That's fine.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Judge.
So I think the way to go is to let Ms. Wilson proceed to say that this is the money that we have, and this is what we are proposing, how it needs to be spent, how it needs to be dispersed. Is that right? And then I'll listen to all the objections which Mr. Merritt has about why it shouldn't be dispersed that way or whatever.
Thank you, Judge. We'll be brief. Michelle Wilson, on behalf of Perry Phillips, we are here because of the order that was entered on the 16th, and we have with us the receiver's second report.
Can you give him a copy to Mr. Merritt?
I will now.
Okay, great.
And on the second report, Judge, and you may recall from last time or may not, we had some fees we were going to collect from the person who was buying the intellectual property, for instance, and we still had some payments to make to consigners from the last auction, and we had proposed to make some of those payments. Well, the payments in your prior order have been made, and the funds that were to be received have been received to the extent they could be, and the total at the bottom line is now $22,115.79. There is an amount of approximately $30,000 owed to the landlord and over $3 million owed to claimants. And we are here today to simply allow the court to go ahead and explain how the court would prefer to distribute the funds. And as to recommendations for distribution, Mr. Phillips wanted to speak to the court as to his recommendation of how those funds maybe could be applied to the claimants as well as to the landlord.
First of all, Mr. Merritt just got that. Would you like me to make like 20 copies of it and then pass it out in the courtroom so everybody can have a copy? Does that help?
If you don't mind, Your Honor, I do appreciate that accommodation.
And that way everybody can kind of look at it and see what's there.
So we do have a lot of folks who aren't technically represented.
Tell me what you need.
Very interested.
Count.
Did everybody raise their hand and would like a copy? I counted about a dozen, Your Honor.
And she wants one too, so why don't you make 20 or so here?
Thank you, Judge.
Thank you. And what I'll do is I'll just let him, because I want to look at it while you're in the office.
Sure. Right. Yes, Your
Honor. So we'll just be in recess for a second.
Okay.
Right.
Thank you, Judge.
You know what? I said, give the students a copy too, they can look at it.
Yeah.
Good. That's smart.
Thank you, Your Honor, for accounting purposes. Well, Justice,
Okay, do you have a problem with the landlord?
No,
he's the attorney for the landlord. Okay.
Perry. Thank you, Your Honor. Very briefly, the rent was to be paid at the end of the case. Normally, in a bankruptcy or receivership situations, you have rent being paid as you go, but in this case, due to the unique nature of the business, obviously some liquidation had to happen. Just to set the background, L.R. Barnes owed W.B. McClanahan and Associates, the landlord, in excess of $180,000. In fact, it was about $185,000 prior to the receivership. Receivership went in place March 15th.
March 15th of this year.
Of this year, 2016, and occupied the premises until June 15th. So it's a very simple 3-month process. At the time the receivership was put in place, rent was $10,000 a month, and that was a reduction from the original $20,000 a month under the original lease. And that change was actually made prior to the appointment of the receiver. So we have 3 months at $10,000. So just during the case, there was $30,000 worth of rent. In addition to that, in conjunction with getting the property back to the consigners, if they could be determined, and then the orderly disposition of the personal property that was inside the premises, the landlord incurred $6,908.50 in cleanup costs, all itemized, all with receipts. And we can present that if the court wishes to see it.
And that was
$6,908.50.
Cleanup costs. Have you got a copy of that to show Mr. Merritt? Have you already shown it to Mr. Phillips and Mr. Wilson?
No, I'd be happy to make some copies and distribute it to them.
Okay, well, look, they need
you can look at this.
Okay, well, thank you. You just got one copy?
I just have one copy.
Yeah, I assume that you object if you didn't pay $6,900.
I do, Your Honor.
Okay. I mean, that's an out-of-pocket cost. That's not,
but I only
theoretical.
There's only $22,000 for missing something. Okay.
And then the one last aspect that has just popped up, and Mr. McClanahan is in the courtroom with us today. He got into the mailbox for that was formerly used by L.R. Barnes and found out that there is a natural gas bill from, Infinite Energy in the name of the landlord, but for meters used by L.R. Barnes in approximately $5,000. So it just keeps coming, and we hope that that's it, but I mean, I hope the court can appreciate the extent to which the landlord has cooperated with the receiver, and I think it was a very orderly and cooperative relationship to get everything to the point we are today. I'm sorry that the pot wasn't larger, but I mean, if we can get as close to our $36,908.50, we would certainly appreciate that, but understanding that the court has a difficult decision to make.
Thank you so much, huh? Thank you.
Thank you.
So he's asking for $36,908.50, but we can round it off. Correct?
That's correct, Your
Honor.
Your Honor, as Paul said and Michelle said, as you can see, there's not even 1 cent to be paid for every dollar's worth of claims in here. And then obviously there's a cost to actually writing the checks. Even if we don't charge the actual administrative cost, there's actually a cost to actually mail the checks themselves. I mean, as you'll notice in the report here, it shows the cost for us to mail out the consigners. I'm glad that Mr. Millsaps is here today, but as a matter of fact, he's one of the people that we actually sold some of his property at the May auction, but we had no way of knowing how to get in touch with him. So you'll actually see on there that we have $217.50 available to Mr. Millsaps.
Well, why don't I hold on just a second, if you don't mind, Mr. Phillips,
yes,
so that we can get those copies, because I'd like for Mr. Millsaps to see it. I'd like for all the other claimants to see it, and everybody can take it. And so I'll just take a little short recess, okay. And then you, once Mr. Binkley's gotten back and distributed it to everybody, then we'll come back into court.
Should we bring it Paul's copy as well while you're going? Okay.
Sure, that's a good idea, Matt. I'll make an extra copy of that.
To the same, should I?
So to this level, I check.
How long, Your Honor?
That's all the one you have.
Yeah, well, listen, how long will Paul break?
At least 15 minutes.
Okay.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you for that.
Case for us, and then I'm using a legal jargon.
I think you have to
clean it. have another layer of.
That's perfect.
Is that good?
Yes, what do you say? So here you have an enviable position of actually answering to everything. Yeah, putting in all the hours of getting things straight.
Yeah.
Clearly, like, we are looking at this.
Remain seated before we turn to order.
Distribute copies to everybody. Got one? Matt, and then Mr. Bigley?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. So I've got one copy of the receiver's report, and you have a copy you filed with the landlord wants to. You got that, Tanya?
I did not get that one.
You're going to get the copy. Is that it? That's the landlord's plan?
That is. Yes.
Okay, so you want us to file that in as part of the record?
Yeah, can you give it to me?
That one's stamped, and is this the one from the receiver stamp?
That's a copy. I still have the original.
You have the original from the receiver. Okay, all right. So now we're ready to hear from Mr. Phillips. He would like to tell us how you came up with this money, how it came to be, and then what disposition we should make. Is that correct?
Okay. Well, I wasn't going to plow over old ground. Last time we were here, September 2nd, I told the board about what all we did.
You don't have to plow over all old ground, but since then you've gotten some more money in or spent some money.
That's right. Yeah,
okay. So hold on a second. I think it would be easier, Mr. Merritt, if he gets on the witness stand because you want to cross-examine him. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So get on the witness stand if you don't mind. And although you're an officer of the court and a member of the bar in good standing, normally you can stay in your place. But for proceedings such as this, I think it's better practice to administer an oath. So if you would raise your right hand, the clerk's going to administer an oath to you.
Okay. You solemnly swear affirm with evidence you shall give the court on the issue pending, shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so you got it.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Have a seat there. Tell us your name.
Perry Phillips.
And what is your capacity in this proceeding?
I am the receiver appointed by the court for L.R. Barnes, LLC, doing business as Four Seasons Auction and Gallery for Forsyth.
And Mr. Barnes is now deceased.
Yes, he died on February 25th.
Of this year?
Of this year, 2016.
Yes. All right.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
I think the court has the report that Ms. Wilson gave to you. It shows the monies that were available. The first line item is June 10th, how much was available at the time I filed my first report. On the first report, there was also three or four people that, according to our information, had not paid when they bought items at the auction on May 7th. And we actually had it scheduled down here as this person, buyer 9213, of $996, but they actually sent us $1,000. So we actually made $3 and something extra. Okay, so that's where that additional money came in. The court approved on September the 2nd. The sale of the intellectual property of Four Seasons to Mr. Farr of Artworks Antiques for $5,000. He had already paid $1,000 that we had already in trust. He also paid a phone bill that he was also going to get the phone account as well. And as a matter of fact, he actually rounded it up. The $3,700 is more than he owed, but that was the amount that was owed, and he sent that check in. I have not prepared the documentation that would totally transfer over anything to him, because, as the court knows, we are using the Four Seasons website and the blast email account that they have to send out notices to people that are on our database about what's happening in this case. The court approved the John McMurray auction fee. And then the rest of the items that are down here are listed, the court approved. I got the statutory fee of $894. And then we had expenses. As I said, I was basically running about 2 months behind, but I had to pay electricity to keep it open. And so I paid that electricity with my credit card and also paid for the security as well. The sales tax that was owed to the Department of Revenue was a computation from the software that was used to show how much was owed, and so that has been paid. And then also the court approved Ms. Wilson's attorney's fees.
We, as part of the reporting that we did, we had, I don't think we listed, Your Honor, the actual names of the consigners, and at least uploaded that information to the court. It was available when we were here on September 2nd, showing different people who had items there based on their consignment numbers and what they received from as a result of this auction. And so it says the payments May 7th, 2000 auction, all those items there are people who whose items were sold that were still there on May 7th, and these are net payments to them. And those total up, those payments, Your Honor, if the math is correct, it may not be, may also be included the other debits on here, but the total amounts that have been paid out since the court saw us was $17,037.36. So it's shown a balance of $22,894.04. There are some people that are listed here, and we're still trying to find them. We have some old emails that we're actually asking you, are they the folks? Mr. Millsaps is entitled to a check for $217.50, but we didn't have anywhere to contact him. And so if Mr. Mayor represents him, if you let us know, we'll be happy to send the check to Mr. Merritt or directly to Mr. Millsaps as well. And then it shows the item here is the postage that's been incurred for actually mailing out all the checks, Your Honor. So you see that. And then we still have the electric bill for another tenant there at the property. The tenant first signed the lease. He delayed in getting the accounts, electrical accounts, had flipped over in his name. And so last fall, I think he went in last summer. Last fall, he signed the document agreeing that he owed a certain amount. He made a payment of around $1,000 on the call. He made two payments. He agreed to pay it all off. He's made two payments, and then all of a sudden says, what proof do you have that I paid for electricity? So, you know, if Ms. Wilson's up there in Forsyth County, can he, I think the fact that he signed a document, I mean, we can file a lawsuit for $454, plus the filing fee is about $85, and that's straight court. So, again, I don't know from an economic standpoint whether it makes sense to go after the group, you know, for, requesting the court to give us some directions on this. If you look at the, I don't know if my list of proofs of claim is absolutely accurate, because I still do not have Rich's client. I understand that she's filed one, but she filed another page when we were here on September 2nd. I gone online and looked at it. It's just one page. Just it doesn't have any documents of the amount. And so I don't know how much. There might be other proofs of claim that were filed in court that were not sent to me, but just the ones that were sent to me. And I filed a proof of claim, Michelle filed a proof of claim, but excluding those proofs of claim that I've taken out from Michelle and myself. The total amounts claimed by the signers is $3,093,344.03. We said they get $3,093,334.03. Now, included in that are two former employees of Dollar Barnes for some money that wrote them at the time that Mr. White died, and Linda Bentley, $397.50. And then over here on the second page, proof of claim 60, Hosey Stilley, $1,085 for the labor. We actually, the report that we filed in September, actually in June, showed some other labor that I paid for Mr. Stilley to help. He was basically helping move stuff around and things like that. So I'd have to go back and actually look at this particular proof of claim to see that entire $1,085. Is valid. Kind of going along, Your Honor, with the thing that Paul suggested in terms of, well, actually, on the board itself, said with respect to the landlord, that the landlord's fees amounts are supposed to be administrative expenses. Because, but for the fact that the landlord allowed us to stay in there, there would have been a dispossessory action now, and then all that stuff would have been sitting down on the parking lot. And whoever wanted to come get it, could come get it, including the people that didn't own it. And so that's one reason the original report signed provides for administrative expense. Obviously, that would just wipe out anything. If the court decides to exercise equitable powers and whatever decides to, you know, reduce that amount, then I think just going along that vein, I think if you still apply the bankruptcy principles, employees, I believe, you are considered to be a preferential person in terms of payments before unsecured creditors are paid. And then, arguably, Your Honor, the folks that actually had items there that are unaccounted for and they get paid for, arguably based on a different classification than anyone that had loaned Mr. White money or all of Barnes money. And so I would think that they would kind of go down to the bottom of the classification. And so what I would suggest that we do, and so do it in that classification and come up with a number, but then let's look at logistics in terms of, and also better cost benefit. If that entire $3,093 was considered and if we were doing $22,000, well, obviously that's less than 1 cent on the dollar. Okay? So that means if you had a claim for less than $100, I'm sending out checks for less than $1. And then I'm incurring a cost of approximately 45 to 50 cents. So I think my suggestion is also come up with some sliding scale based on what your court does, and then just basically say any claims less than a certain amount won't get paid because it just doesn't make any more sense to pay. So it's a little bit hard to figure out. If there might be a way, Your Honor, in a normal situation like in a bankruptcy, there might be somebody that actually would go through and get paid to go through all these claims, and they might cram some of these claims down to disallow some of them. But there's nobody to do that, and I can't have my staff doing that. I'm already out $40,000 that I'm not getting paid as a result of all the work.
The time you have in the case.
The time my staff has, yes, sir.
$40,000 for which you've only been paid, I think I saw $800?
$894 plus
business. $894, okay.
Yes, sir. So, yeah, I'm basically saying, Judge, I don't know what to do, so it gets to fall on you.
Can you pay that for us?
No, that's okay.
Right. Do you have any cross examination? Do you, Your
Honor? Mr. Phillips, have you ever served as a receiver before?
No.
And I know we've worked together in previous cases. Just for the record, how many years have you practiced law?
37.
And in your 37 years of experience practicing law, have you ever been counsel in a case involving a receiver?
No.
So this is your first foray into receivership in any form, correct?
It is.
And given that this would be your initial experience dealing with the concept of receivership under Georgia law, how did you acquaint yourself with the roles and duties under the receivership statute?
I reviewed the statute, and then I talked to the people that were involved and the employees that worked at the business, and I went and found out where the assets are. I went to SunTrust, which according to documents we had, there were accounts at SunTrust, and I inquired of the personnel of any other accounts that there might be other than accounts at SunTrust. There weren't any. Matter of fact, at the time of Mr. White's death, I think there were all the accounts combined were overdrawn to $35,000. And then I just went to the warehouse itself and learned how the property was marked in terms of whether it was an item that was owned by Four Seasons as a result of his 25-30 years over the years of being involved in the auction business and buying and selling items, how those were marked, and then how other consigners were actually, their items were marked. I was shown the books that they kept. They didn't keep records on computer for purposes of the documentation of the consignments, the different consignment agreements that were signed. They're actually in books, and I have all the books in my office. They are all just on pieces of paper, and then consignors, when they would come in, if they consigned goods more than one time, there would actually be, behind the actual consignment agreement, would be a list of items and set forth the date that they were actually provided to Four Seasons, and then items that have been sold, they would actually have sale dates on there, as well as the amounts brought at the auction itself. So they have, numbers had gotten up to around 9,600 in terms of the consignment numbers by the time of Mr. White's death. They had filing cabinets of old records.
And let me just stop you there for purposes of clarity. Let me interrupt you, but I think it'll be easier.
Okay.
For everybody following along. When you say they, you're referring to
the people at Four Seasons.
Four Seasons Auction Gallery, Forsyth.
Yeah, the people at Four Seasons.
And that's the only entity of the former Steve White or the late Steve White that we're dealing with in this receivership, correct?
That's right.
And what about him individually? Is he part of the receivership individually, or is it just a business?
Okay. I only file on behalf of Allen Barnes LLC.
All right. And were there any employees or former employees of Four Seasons Auction that you were able to interview to get a sense as to how he kept his records? And
yeah, Linda Bentley had been with him for several years, and so she was the person that provided the information to him.
Anybody other than Ms. Bentley?
No, because she was the only one that was really involved on a day-to-day basis in terms of the actual record keeping. There were other people that served to help at auctions themselves, to basically do all the paperwork related to it, but they weren't involved in the day-to-day running of the business more in terms of the actual payment of the signers after auctions occurred. So when it was the source.
And who assisted you on your side of things with the staff?
Just me.
Anybody with your law firm help out?
Well, with respect to interviews, no. With respect to the preparation of the various reports are filed, to keeping track of the expenses. My paralegal did substantially most of it. I also had a bookkeeper, a part-time bookkeeper, that was involved in keeping track of the monies as well. And then I have another woman who works part-time, Barbara Marsh, who enters time, but she also does filing, and so she does some keeping track of records as well.
And the first two folks you mentioned for the record, what are their first and last names?
First person's name is Lucia Matten, M-A-T-T-E-R-N. And the second person's name is Pam Pittman.
And I want to back up a second before I proceed. You would agree with me that Georgia law and supporting case laws to receivership makes it quite clear that a receiver does have a fiduciary array of responsibilities, correct?
I don't disagree.
Okay.
There's no basis for the claim that I have not done that.
And I'm going to ask you, what is your understanding generally as to what those fiduciary responsibilities are?
To account for the assets, account for expenditures.
And can you provide testimony as to what your understanding of the role of receiver in this particular matter, the idea of priority of creditors? In other words, we have a landlord here who's making a claim to essentially wipe out what has been presented as all the available cash or assets. You have several people in this courtroom who would beg to differ, and we'll hear from them in due course. But what is your opinion, or how have you been operating as the priority of creditors? Is there one creditor that perhaps trumps another, or is everybody on equal footing in this particular matter?
So far, the only people that have been paid are people that have been paid pursuant to a request of the court to approve expenses that have been incurred related to the accumulation of the assets and also allowing to sell them. The attorney's fees that were allowed by the statute for the receiver, auction fee of $500, which the person submitted his claim saying that was a reasonable fee, Those are, and then my administrator, my receiver fees in the statute. Those are the only, and then obviously the payment to consignors that were based on the consignment agreements signed by the consignors in terms of how much net they received. And then with respect to the receiver statute itself, I do not believe that there actually is a priority like there's a bankruptcy. Okay? But there hasn't been any distribution to anyone based on priority. All these payments have been made so far are based on statutory provisions in the receivership statute, plus the expenses related to the maintaining the electricity so that the property could be gathered and the auction could occur, and then also the auction could actually held the auctioneer. That's not that much.
Now, it's my understanding that you, prior obviously to his passing, that you represented Steve White as his attorney, correct?
I did, and of course, you know, I think pretty good time to interject. At the first hearing that was held on his appointment back in March, wasn't first Flournoy, it was
Krieger.
No, well, Krieger was the very first one, but there was actually a hearing. It was actually the judge that's Jeff Hamby, it's juvenile court judge, I think. But there was about an hour and a half gathering of people, an opportunity for people to express. And Judge Hamby says, as a matter of fact, I think your client, Ms. Michaels, objected to being appointed receiver. And so he says, does anyone else want to be a receiver? So the reason I became the receiver was because I got an email from Mr. White about 2 hours before he committed suicide, asking me to be the executor of his estate. Now, obviously I knew that I didn't know what it meant until I found out that he died, but I knew that meant more, because he actually said all of arms, he meant more than just being the executor. He's basically saying, please take, and he actually said he knows that it was worth more. And so, he asked me to do it, I did.
And obviously I wasn't there retained at that particular time, but my question simply is, prior to being appointed receiver, you had represented Mr. White in this business, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. And I don't need to know every case or matter, but if you can recall, just what span of years are we talking about that you acted as his counsel?
My recollection is the first year I represented, I believe it was 2002 or 2003.
And more or less off and on, correct me if I'm wrong, you represented him in some capacity up until his death?
Yes.
Okay, so that's about a, my math is correct, you said 2002, 13, 14 years? Okay. And again, not getting into the minutiae of individual cases, did you serve as counsel in a particular litigation matter, or were you serving in an in-house capacity, or both?
Well, I don't know what you mean by in-house.
Just providing general business advice if he had any questions.
Well, if he called me, if he thought he needed to call me or write me or email me, then he would do so. And then depending on the circumstances, I may assist him. Or other times I may say it's not worth the deal. A lot of times his calls were, this person hasn't paid, this person wrote a bad check. Those kind of things is what I assist him in, as well as suits that he filed as well.
And my understanding is that you, vis-a-vis your law firm, are a creditor in this matter?
No, I didn't file a proof of claim for anything that was owed to me prior to his death. Not $1.
So you're seeking simply your fees and expenses as a receiver?
Okay, I've already been awarded my fees as a receiver.
And you haven't incurred any since the last award of fees?
Well, okay. I've been awarded the statutory fees, and as a matter of fact, I have filed proofs of claim showing in terms of fees and fees that were done by either me or by my paralegal that are in excess of $30,000. I asked the judge, I said, let's just wait on that to see how everything falls out, knowing as a practical matter that I wasn't going to get it.
Right. So.
And I'm not asking for any now. There's not enough money available.
But you did submit a proof of claim.
I did, in order to protect my rights, just in case someone later would claim that I was not submit proof of claim, I wasn't entitled to anything, even under the statute.
All right, let's talk about the website briefly. Who set up the website?
I have no idea.
Do you know what firm you retained to set up the website?
I have no idea.
Who set up the website?
You've asked that twice.
And I still haven't received an answer. I'm just asking the same question.
I can't tell you anything other than I have no idea.
Well, as the receiver, the website presumably was set up to assist you in processing these claims.
No, it was an existing website.
I see. Okay. Well, tell me about that briefly. How did that website come into existence? Do you know?
I have no idea.
But this
I think he's saying that Mr. White, before his death, had already set up some kind of website.
Absolutely.
That's all I'm trying to figure out, and I'll move on. But I'm trying to figure out this website, and the reason being, Mr. Phillips, is that, and correct me if I'm wrong, this website was set up by somebody at some point to assist in processing these claims, right?
Wrong.
Okay, what was the website?
The website has existed for years, as far as I'm aware. And as I understand it, Mr. White was the webmaster. Now, there may have been somebody that designed it for him years and years and years ago, but he maintained it. My understanding is that there was an access to it, that there was a password and a username that they could go in and make changes to it. All right? And so what they've used that website for was to announce auctions that are coming and other things. And so what we did was basically use that front page as a way to get out notices to everyone, because we had no money at the time that we started sending out notices to pay anyone to actually go through all the records that they had. As I said, most of them were not computerized, and to come up with a list of addresses and phone numbers and emails of anyone. Okay, so that was a way that we could use. There was also and so this person assisted us in doing that. And posting the information on that website. Once the auction ended, then Mr. Farr, and for approval, Mr. Farr has maintained that website still and still posts orders that have been entered up on the website. Likewise, with respect to an email database that was maintained by Four Seasons, I believe it costs money to, it goes through one of these services that actually sends out these blast emails. And so we had that access as well. So emails were actually, when they said it was first filed and the orders were entered, email blast also went out saying go to the website to get it. And then occasionally documents were actually attached as part of the email blast. And then we created a database ourselves as well, from lawyers getting in touch with us, consigners getting in touch with us, people who said that they were owed money from their notes. And so we created a database. So a lot of times people, there's an overlap. But I wanted to make sure that there was no question whatsoever that people are getting notice dealt the best way I could. And so we created a database of the emails and all we said that.
So your firm created a database and you started compiling information, including contact information, to reach out to possible claimants, correct?
That's right.
And the source of data for that information could have been this old website, could have been inquiries from lay people, lawyers, whatever source whatsoever. You threw it in there because you wanted to try to get in touch with folks.
That's right.
Fair assessment. Okay.
And that's what, as a matter of fact, the word that was entered said that's the way I was going to communicate with anyone who had a potential interest in the receivership.
Was there any type of introductory letter or email sent to folks whose contact information you had to let them know what was going on?
Yeah, it's in the order. It said, please read the order.
And describe for me the requirement of the proof of claim.
Well, when the original order was ended, it just said for them to file a proof of claim. And so we were getting, between that time it was entered by Judge Creeper and the time we had a hearing in front of Judge Hanby, I received a lot of emails. I'm not a lawyer. I don't know what to do. And of course, I didn't feel it was my place to tell them what to do. And so when we came and had the second hearing, then I brought a form. I took the proof of claim form from the bankruptcy form and made some changes to it. And we created it, and it was approved, and that was posted on the website as well.
And if somebody submitted a proof of claim that didn't exactly match this form that came to be, would you still consider it to be a legitimate proof of claim?
I have listed every single person that said in any way, form, or fashion that they are asserting a claim for certain amount, as far as I'm aware. If somebody says that they're not on the list, then I don't know. The order actually at first said they were supposed to submit claims to me. It seemed to be the best way to know exactly what we're supposed to have. However, especially considering the hearing, the second hearing, when so many people showed up, wanted to make sure it's above board, no question whatsoever. And so the order was actually changed to require that all proofs of claim be filed with the board, but provide me with a copy. And as far as I know, most people did that, but as I said, Ms. Blankles did not send me a proof of claim.
And once somebody submitted a proof of claim, what exactly did you or your staff do to enter the information in your database?
Well, we scanned it, and then it was recorded. And a spreadsheet prepared that we had the names and the amounts that they were claiming.
And once that happened, what would be the next event in your procedure? Would there be a follow-up call or correspondence to the claimant asking them more about what it was they were claiming, or would you proceed towards trying to evaluate and provide monies for their claim?
As I just told the court today, I have not evaluated any claim that's here because the numbers doesn't make economic sense to make that evaluation. There is no money to pay to go through every one of these proofs of claim to see whether the claim is valid or not.
Well, we haven't
done that yet.
Sorry. Well, we have a $3.5 million total amount of claims, correct?
No. I just said $3,093,334.
I'm sorry, what was the number again?
$3,093,334.
Okay. Well, 3 million, that's a significant amount. And we've heard several times already today at this hearing that I believe, looking at your second report, $22,115.79 is what's left.
That's right.
Is that correct?
I'm assuming you read it correctly, Mr. Merriman.
Well, I'm not the one who offered it, so if you could just confirm that, we can move on.
Okay, well, I didn't know that. So
page
shows three. Here that there are $22,115.79 available with the possibility of collecting another $854.49.
Right. So do you have any idea, as the receiver in this case, as to where the approximately $2,970,000 difference may reside?
I don't know that if the claims were worth $2 million.
Because you didn't evaluate them, you said yourself.
Because there's no money to evaluate them.
So if there's no money by your estimation, then you're just not going to bother, is what I'm hearing, correct?
I'm asking the court for guidance as to how to handle it. Yes. And if you would like to take over the receivership, I'm fine with you, and you can evaluate.
I'm all booked up. Thank you, sir. Appreciate the offer. And it's your recommendation to the court, or maybe your recommendation to the court, that the landlord should be paid what they're entitled to, and I would essentially wipe this out?
I'm not making a recommendation to the court. I only pointed out that the order that was entered, and Mr. Dzikowski was there at the time, said that the landlord would be entitled to administrative expense for the rent. If, in the normal course, as a matter of fact, I think the letter came the day after he died, Mr. Dzikowski had written me a demand letter for saying you owe $180,000 worth of rent, and that they would be required to, that if we didn't pay it, that they would involve his possessory. Of course, if we didn't have $180,000, so if they had filed a dispossessory action, the court would enter an order granting the rent and granting possession. And so all the
property, all the cars, and I made sure got back to everybody. All the other items were there that people were able to come back and pick up if they desired to do so. And there was a day that, a lot of people picked up a lot of items that they would have lost their property. And so, as a result, that's the reason it's an administrative expense, because he incurred costs to allow others to be compensated or at least recover their property.
So let me ask you about the bank accounts. I presume as the receiver you set up at least one escrow account or some sort of bank account specifically for this process?
No, I ran it through, my trust account, because there was no money available to pay the fees to set up another account at the time that I was appointed receiver.
So you as receiver ran the monies through your law firm trust account, is that correct?
That's right.
Okay. So any checks that were issued to folks were on, obviously, a check from your law firm trust account, correct?
Yeah.
Are there any physical items still at any location as we talk here today?
Yeah, there is records in my office.
There's one in your office?
Records in my office.
Oh, records.
Right. Let me be a little more clear. Are there any items that may belong to some sort of claimant?
Any antiques?
Antiques.
Any furniture?
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay. So no, your car. Representation of the court is that all items have been disposed of?
My representation of the court and everything that was in the Four Seasons warehouse has been picked up or sold.
And that's the only location any such items would be, correct?
Or as far as I'm aware.
Have you ever done, as required by the order and the receivership statute, any type of formal accounting?
Yes,
as receiver?
These reports are accounting.
Right. And you consider these reports to be acceptable accounting for purposes of this matter?
No one's objected to it.
Well, they are now.
Okay, well, I'm your objection.
Well, that's the basis of my questioning. But you were, per Judge Krieger's order from March 15th of 2016, required to make an inventory and accounting, correct?
I was required to make an inventory. I had no ability to make a specific inventory because there was no one who would actually prepare the inventory to do it.
And per paragraph 8 of that order, you would win 60 days after the entry of that order to file a report.
Right.
And that initial report didn't happen in time, did it?
No.
And why is that?
Because I was still, one, the auction, we were hoping to do the auction at the end of April as opposed to middle to late April. But we weren't able to do it May 7th. It was, matter of fact, it wasn't until April 3rd that I actually had an auctioneer who was going to be able to auction the items. If, in fact, I had not had an auctioneer, then I was just going to auction the items that were in the Four Seasons and then again send out a blast to everyone else who still had stuff there to come get it. So the logistics of not having money to pay people to do the work slowed down the process of doing that. And then once we got the auction heard, then I had to get the information from the computer system. I had to speak with evidently other people that run it to get to understand the reports they ran to me so that I could prepare the report.
And I believe paragraph 24 of that same March 15, 2016 order from Judge Krieger also stated that after receipt of the bids, the receiver shall advise the court and a hearing shall be scheduled to determine the successful bidder. And the reality is that you never did this, correct?
What are we talking about?
I'm talking about the order, March 15, 2016.
Successful bidder.
Yes. Paragraph 24, I'm quoting.
Okay, I don't have it in front of you, Mr. Mayor, so you're going to have, there was, the process was that we had.
He's talking about this. Here's the We're going to see if anybody can buy the business known as LR Barnes LLC. Nobody.
No, nobody did. All I had was that.
I was going to ask you a question.
All I had, Mr. Merritt, was in order to get bids, I actually began when there were several people that contacted me that talked about buying the
well,
all the assets. Do you want his answer or not?
I apologize. Take your time.
To buy all the assets of Four Seasons. And so they said, I will need you to prepare all these accounting reports to provide us. You would also have to identify us with any liability if we have to buy these assets. And so I couldn't do that. So two of them went away. The only person left was Charles Paul.
Charles?
Charles Paul.
F-A-R-R.
P-H-A-R-R.
P-H-A-R.
That's right. Yeah. And so he didn't buy the business itself. What he did was he offered to buy the assets of Four Seasons that still remained, plus the, quote, intellectual property of Four Seasons. At the auction on May 7th, it was announced that there had been a bid for all the Four Seasons auction of, I think it was $11,000 to $14,000, I can't remember the exact amount. And so the auctioneer announced that it was going to be sold in bulk. If anyone wanted to make a bid for the entire stock, the entire property, that they were free to make a bid. They weren't going to take each and every single item and bid at different amounts.
Well, I want to refer you to paragraph 4 of that order if you could turn back to that specific paragraph, because I think it's very important to this discussion.
Paragraph 4?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And I'm going to quote, the receiver shall perform an accounting of all inventory, merchandise, products, assets, or things of value in possession, custody, or control of any party in which LR Barnes and or Four Seasons has an interest, to perform an evaluation of the inventory and ensure that any liquidation, sale, or disposition of the inventory takes place in a commercially reasonable manner so as to maximize the value and profitability of LR Barnes and or Four Seasons.
That's right.
Would you agree with me that this is very clear language as to the directive you're supposed to follow as the receiver?
And I agree, and I also agree that I did that. I actually asked other people, what is this property worth? I did speak to people, and I did get other people to come out and look at it. I mentioned the people that sent emails, but a couple other people came over again and said, that's the best offer it's worth. Most of this stuff is junk.
But you didn't do an accounting, as you testified previously.
No, I have done an accounting. In my view, the report is the accounting. Mr. Merritt, don't twist my words.
And I believe you also testified you did not do an evaluation of the inventory either.
I did not inventory. I.e., take every piece and write it down and say, this is the item. I had no one who could do that, Mr. Merritt.
Well, you had a prior employee. Did you ask them to assist?
Yeah, and they refused because there were a lot of people threatening them, and so they refused to even come up there.
Did you highlight these concerns to the court at any point?
I've mentioned it to the court before. I actually had to arrange for a wellness check by the Marietta police because of threats made to me. Actually, the last year that we were here on September the 2nd, a gentleman showed up at my office at 12:30. Who did not come to the hearing, it started at 9:30, I think it ended around 11:30, 11:45, and wanted his own counsel with me to find out what to do. And so I told him what I told him before when he was at Four Seasons. He kept insisting, and I told him, I said, you're going to have to leave. I'm going to call 911.
I'm going to ask you briefly about the five folks that I actually you presently represent, although there are numerous other interested parties here. Mm-hmm. You can certainly tell the court their concerns or questions at the appropriate time. Do you remember anybody by the name of Dr. John and Bessie Downing?
Yeah, they've got a check for approximately $3,500 that was sent to them.
Are you aware that their amount of loss is $200,000?
I'm not aware that the rental loss is $200,000. I am aware that they had items that they valued, that they may have paid for that. But in an auction, Mr. Mayor, people buy property for what they're willing to pay for.
Gary Gibbs, does that ring a bell?
I think he sends me an email every week about some breakfast, a bunch of guys that like cars.
And I believe there was a vehicle sold to Mr. Farr, correct?
Vehicle, I'm not aware of any vehicle sold to Mr. Farr.
He's claiming a loss of $6,000. Does that ring a bell?
I don't know. I mean, as a proof of claim, I haven't, like I said, I have not reviewed the proof of claim. Mr. Mayor, you weren't involved before, but as you know, the original petition, and I think one of the reports said there was approximately, I think, 14 cars that were there at the time not being the auctioneer. And because none of the auctioneers that were going to possibly auction off the property were licensed and authorized to sell cars. And so as a result, I had to contact every single owner of a vehicle that's still there to come get their cars. As a matter of fact, we actually got a few bucks because some monies were owed for some repairs that were made, and some people came and got their cars. Those are the cars that were there at the time.
Right, my next client that I currently represent is a Donnie Millsaps from Tennessee. He's claiming $15,000 in damages, and I believe you stated previously today that you have a check for him if he so chooses to accept it.
I want to know why he wouldn't. I'm not intending to preclude from accepting that and affecting his claim that he has separate apart from that. These are monies that are owed to him as a result of the sale of items that were identified as vintage items on May 7th auction.
And then we have Sarah Morgan, who is an 85-year-old mother of Pamela Michaels, who is a client of mine. And you claim you never received a proof of claim, correct?
Yeah. Yep.
And she's seeking $250,000.
I believe that's around here. I've received letters that were delivered to me that had been sent to Mr. Martin, maybe as a social provider.
My fifth client of record at this point would be Rob White. He's not present here today. He couldn't travel from South Carolina, but I can represent his place as counsel that he's seeking $25,500. Do you have any knowledge as to his claim?
No. Do you know what it's for? Is it for property or for monies that he lost?
I'm sorry?
Do you know if it's property or money that he lost?
I believe money.
Okay. I know that. I don't remember any of these people that you just mentioned, the five, other than Ms. Michaels. Did they file proof of claim?
Well, if the court will indulge me, I do have those five people to provide testimony here in court. They can discuss quickly what they did and their interactions with the receivership.
Well, let's finish with Mr. Phillips.
Yes, sir.
I'll let you call whatever witnesses you want to call.
That's all I have this time, Ron.
All right. Do you have any additional testimony for you?
Yeah.
All right. And do you have any questions for me? Okay. All right, let me have an order back.
Yes, I'm sorry.
That's right. And so you can step down. And so does the receiver have any additional evidence that he wishes to talk?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. And all right, so the receiver, and we heard from Mr. Dzikowski about the landlord wanting $36,900. Do y'all have any?
I'm sorry.
We've heard from the receiver that he has $22,800 in change that he would like direction from the court as to what to do with that. And so we've heard from the landlord alone that they are asserting a claim of $36,900, which far exceeds what they have. So do you have any witnesses you want to call, Mr. Mayor?
Yes, Your Honor. I would like to call my five clients. I'll try to be brief and to the point. And then after that, I'll make argument. And of course, it'll be your call.
You don't have to be brief. We've got all afternoon.
Thank you, Judge. Mr. Millsaps. I'm calling Donnie Millsaps to the stand, Your Honor.
Okay. Come around if you would, Mr. Millsaps. Ready to step up on the witness stand and raise your right hand. And the clerk will administer an oath.
Yes, I'm sure I've heard that I wish I should get the court on the issue. have you got?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you please say and spell your name for the court report?
Donnie Millsaps, DONNYMILLSAPS.
Thank you, sir. Just have a seat. Lawyer's going to ask you some questions.
Good morning, Mr. Millsaps. Where do you presently reside?
Athens, Tennessee.
And how far of a drive is it from Athens, Tennessee to Marietta, Georgia?
To 2.5 hour drive.
And you made that trip and undertook that personal expense because you wanted to tell the court your side of the story here today, correct?
Yes, sir.
I want you to please tell the court how you first came to interact with Steve White and his business, Four Seasons Auction Gallery, Forsyth.
I had dealt with Four Seasons back in 2012. It's just listed also on the thing. But in 2015, in December, we had taken items down to be auctioned, and everything was filed and consignment plan that we had and everything else. And I talked to Steve White about certain other items that he was going to have appraised at the time there in January, because we were looking at a major art auction in January that we had one piece that was to go to sale. Then we never did receive any information on any of the sales. We made phone calls all the way through the month of February.
Now, what year are you talking about?
2016.
Thank you.
We didn't get any response back. Finally, they said send everything by email. We did receive an email for one of the checks that we never did get paid for. It's listed also. Mr. Merritt has that copy that we had filed through the courts, and also we didn't receive anything back at that time. So in the month of March, toward the middle of March, that's when we found out about Mr. White's death. Still had not figured out what was going on with our property that was down there. And so we had made a request to see what we needed to do. And we had sent emails directly to fourseasongallery.com about what we needed to do about coming and getting our stuff or what was fixing to be done. No response was ever sent. So in the month of April, we sent another form email to Four Seasons Gallery listing all the claim that we had there on our list that we still was waiting on to be paid for, what we needed to do. No response. Then at the end of April is when we finally went back and seen the website that Mr. Phillips and them had posted up, or whoever done the website at that time, to where to address everything. I contacted Michelle Wilson on the 3rd of May, and she said report everything to Mr. Phillips. So at that time, my father was in the hospital, so I let my son on May the 5th contact Mr. Phillips' office.
And your son is here in court today?
Yes, sir.
And his name is?
Keith Jackson.
Thank you, sir.
And so he proceeded to call Mr. Phillips, and Mr. Phillips sort of got smart with him, agitated, and said there wasn't nothing he could do about it. And we was trying to actually send the forms to him. So on May the 6th, I contacted Mr. Phillips' office, and he done the same thing with me. He said there was no way, he didn't have anything else to do with it. We could not send any forms to him, fax any information to him at all at that time, that we had to do it through the court by May the 9th. Well, we contacted the court on May the 7th, where we need to send everything to it, and come to find out, Michelle Wilson let it slip. Mr. Phillips was supposed to be in at court on May the 9th, which he could have actually took our form and our claim to the courthouse and have it submitted, which he did not do. He just pushed us to the side. So we sent our claim in. We had sent it by Federal Express to get it there on which was the Tuesday instead of that Monday, which would have been the 10th. And we had contacted the courthouse, and they said it was 2 weeks backup with all the claims that was coming in. And he told us, well, he told me on May the 7th, the 6th, that it was up to the judge to allow our claim to be submitted to anything that came up into the court. And we have never received anything else. No phone calls or anything else from Mr. Phillips' group until 2 weeks ago. He's stating that he did not have any way to contact me. Well, it's amazing how he got my phone number 2 weeks ago, contacted me and asked me, he told me, his secretary, I guess, said that they had a check for me. And I asked for what the amount of the check was. They said, I cannot disclose that amount at this time. So it's amazing, if he could not contact me any other time, how could he contact me 2 weeks ago?
And what are the damages that you're seeking, or the amount of?
It's $15,000, and that is a auction value.
And what is the item?
One of the items is a Marsha Gold painting, which was appraised for between $5,000 and $15,000. There's also appraisal of $10,000 worth of human wigs, down human hair wigs, that were designer wigs. Not counting, there are military artifacts from World War I. Also, there is a military ring stated from 1935 to 1938. It was 14 karat gold plus silver with an opal center in it, which was a military commander ring. There's also an Indian pottery boat. It was dated from around 1600s. That was also supposed to be appraised by Steve White at the time, which they never did get back with us on it. There's also a stamp collection. There's belt buckles. There's, there's a whole bunch. There's a big list of it.
Do you have any knowledge as to if any of these things were sold?
No. The only items that we had gotten that they had sent us, which is what we sent you, was a small check for $52 or $57, which was for a silver spoon and some black art. Three pieces of the black art had sold, and that was it.
So to be clear for the court, you have no idea if these items were sold, correct?
Nope.
And if they were, you had no idea what for?
Nope.
Is there anything else you'd like to tell the board?
Oh, sir.
Thank you.
Do you have any questions?
Couple. Mr. Millsaps, what is your email address?
It's donnymillsaps@yahoo.com.
D-O-N-N-Y Millsaps at Gmail?
Yep.
And what's your phone number?
It's Sarah 423-506-5360.
And what's your consignor number?
I don't have that in front of me right now.
Do you have it at home?
It should be with Mr. Merrick.
Okay.
Do you need him to give you that? Do you want to?
Well, I believe Mr. Phillips would need that number in order to confirm what exactly
the question was. Do you like to stand there and get the consignor number?
And also a copy of the client.
We can have a moment, Your Honor, or we can proceed to other witnesses, and I can get it however you want to handle it. If she wants to question him.
I don't have any other questions for Mr. Millsaps,
Judge. It's not going to be a record here unless we do it logically and rationally,
sure. And
we do it in an orderly fashion. So if you want to go back and talk to your son, he has the claim. You can walk back there and get it from your son. Is that what
he's got the claim.
No, I just need to confer with my client.
Okay, then you confer with your client.
PDF of the items that we had.
There should be a list.
It's down.
It should be a sheet just like that.
It should be,
but it's too short.
Not in the materials I downloaded that I thought I had. However, the son who's present can pull up the consignment number and I can provide that. He's doing so now.
Okay.
That's just proof of claim, and he can certainly go back on the stand and testify.
Ms. Wilson was simply saying, would you tell me the consignment number? And it was 4872 or whatever the number was, and then she could go and see if in the records, that Mr. White's records, it shows that Mr. Millsaps on a certain day, I think it was in January, delivered a Marsha Bell painting. She would look and see. Did he in fact deliver 12 human hair wigs? You follow me?
That's yes, sir.
Just kind of spouting off the various stuff.
And so, we can provide that number. The issue
you think
is
you can. All right. Well, do you want to come back on the witness stand? Is there any other questions you want from him and Ms. Wilson?
Yes, Your Honor, just a few.
And he's saying, Mr. Phillips is saying, how about his proof of claim?
Understood, Judge. And his son went to get his phone. He left it in a car, so he didn't bring it to the courthouse, and he'll have it.
Okay. Mr. Phillips is saying he never got a proof of claim from Mr. John Millsap. That's fine. All right. Why don't we do this? It's 5 till 12, and we'll go to lunch. And then when we come back from lunch, you will have prepped your other, because I think that you're going to pick each of your clients up there, and they're all going to say that we entrusted Mr. White while he was still alive an antique piano, or whatever the
yes, sir.
Entrusted by, a Schiffer rug, a wonderful, beautiful antique dining room table with matching 8 chairs. Beautiful. It's a Queen Anne style, whatever. And so we'll need another consignment number.
Yes,
and
sir.
If they have a list, it would have been nice if when they surrendered all this kind of stuff to Mr. White, if they had signed something and we had a photocopy of that. She'd like to see that too.
And we do already have some of that, and I appreciate the lunch break. We'll get it together whenever we're told to report.
Because I anticipate that's the kind of question you're going to ask each one of them.
Yes, Your Honor, because we're going to need to confirm.
He'll go back and look at the records and see, did in fact they surrender a World War I military artifact?
Yes,
that's what he said he did. All right.
Fair.
So we'll be in recess between now and we'll just come back and say 1:30.
Thank you, Judge.
More than
anything.
I asked about that email.
My court reporter says that you sent an email address and and she repeated the email address back, and you've repeated a different email address than the one that he gave. So y'all, she has an email address he gave from the witness stand, and you parroted it back, but your email address is incorrect. Now, do you want to have the correct email address?
Yes.
All right. Would you come up, Mr. Millsaps, and real slowly, tell the email address.
Sorry. Thank you, Judge.
You don't have to take the witness stand. You just tell her that. And I think Ms. Wilson would like to have it.
Okay. It's donymilsaps at yahoo.com.
Thank you. Thank you, Judge.
Back at 1:30. Now that you have this case involving the Wells Fargo, are y'all ready to do that? Yours is just simply a motion to dismiss his appeal, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. So what I'll do then is I'll tell you what, why don't y'all come back at 2:00? Did you hear that, Mayor?
Sir.
2:00.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
2:00.
I'll let everybody know.
Time, and that way I can take care of y'all.
Thank you, Judge.
Remain seated. Call the court to order, please.
Millsaps was on the witness stand, and he had been asked what was his consign or number. And so, you still want to know that?
Yes.
All right. And then you asked about his proof of claim. He had a copy.
Your Honor, if I may, at this time, I do have a copy of his proof of claim, his inventory list, and his consignor number.
Okay.
It's not formally in evidence. If you want to stipulate to it,
sure,
then you can have at it.
Don't you want to make part of this record?
Absolutely, that's
okay. So I would think this would be what are
we? Well, we're not
really anything.
We're just
intervening already. What?
Intervening claimant, interested party.
Okay. This will you say that you're, and I'm not being flippant about it, but the following claimants, and you represent these claimants.
Yes, sir.
So this is claimant Donnie Millsaps, proof of claim. All
yes.
Right.
Correct.
All right, so wait a minute, bring it up. You want to hand it to Tanya? Do you want to file it in, Tanya? Or do you want it to be part of the, attached to the transcript if somebody orders a transcript? Y'all going to follow me?
Yes, Your Honor.
Well, Your Honor, that's fine.
Just file it. Tanya says it's better just to file it with the clerk.
Exactly. Then at some point, I might get a copy.
Do what now?
At some point, I might actually get a copy because I don't
know. You don't have multiple copies? Okay.
File it in.
We're just filing it in, and it's part of the clerk's record then. All right. And so, you want to, and I think what you're saying is you want me to get Mr. Binkley to make a copy for you right now.
No, I don't need it right now. I just need it before I leave today.
Okay.
Right, and so you want to ask any other questions?
Just a couple more.
I didn't hear him say the consign or number, but you got it. It's on that piece of paper.
Your Honor, it is. Okay, I think it was 2747.
Yes, ma'am.
And then, Mr. Millsaps, I just wanted to ask you a quick question about how you knew to call me. I believe it was because you said you were receiving the Four Seasons emails, right?
No, was not receiving any Four Seasons emails. No.
How did you know that Steve White and
We found it on the website. In April.
Then how did you know to call me?
Because your name is listed on the website with your phone number as well.
Okay, good. So, and I told you to call Perry Phillips.
Yes, ma'am.
And Perry Phillips told you to file your claim with the court.
Yes.
And you actually did file it.
Yes.
Good.
That's all the questions I have, Judge.
When?
Oh, when? Well, the date, the court, the date of filing is on the front of the claim.
It is. What's the date?
The date is May 24th.
Okay.
So May 24th, is that what you want to call the date?
It went in on May the 9th or May the 10th.
When you say it went in, do you think, are you saying that's when FedEx delivered it to the courthouse?
Yes.
Okay.
It's filed stamped May 24th, though. That's really good.
Yes.
Yes, that's
refiled.
It's already been filed once, May 24th, and today y'all are filing it yet again, so it'll have another stamp on it of October 28th. So it's been
been filed twice.
Okay.
Thank you, Judge.
Anything else?
That's it.
Any, no question, any redirect, can he come down?
No, Your Honor.
Okay, I'll just step down, thank you. Do you have any other witnesses?
Yes, Your Honor.
Thank you.
This time we'd like to call Pamela Michaels.
This is Michaels, M-I-C-H-A-E-L with an S?
Yes, Your Honor.
Pamela, this is first.
Pamela Michaels.
Pamela Michaels.
Do you want both?
Thank you, ma'am. Right hand of the clerk with Mr. Nydia. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, you raise your right hand, please. You sign this where I'm from. The evidence you shall give the court on this opinion shall be the truth. How would you know the truth if you got to it? Thank you.
I'm sorry, if you'll do me a favor, I can't see you. So if you'll just put that right next to you or down.
I just wanted to be sure that.
No, the perfect.
We did that.
Yeah, thank you. I just can't see you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Michaels, where do you presently reside?
Wait a minute, give her the state name.
I'm sorry, I thought you may have done that. I apologize, I wasn't paying attention. Please state your full name for the record.
Pamela Michaels.
And where do you presently reside, ma'am?
Alabama with my mother right now.
And what is your mother's name?
Sarah Morgan.
And is Sarah Morgan also part of the proof of claim that was submitted in this case?
She is the proof of claim.
And you're assisting her in this matter?
I am, power of attorney.
At any point did you submit a proof of claim in this particular matter?
Yes.
Your Honor, if I may approach.
Sure.
You take a look at that, ma'am. Do you recognize that document?
I do.
Did you create that document?
My mother did.
But you are familiar with it?
I am.
And can you describe for the court what that document is?
It's a proof of claim listing the amount of her claim and the elder abuse and financial exploitation and gain, the Ponzi, the death by conversion, the death by extortion. Shall I go on?
Well, I just, for this purposes of this, I just need to know what that document is. That is the proof of claim you submitted in this case, correct?
Yes, sir, yes.
Okay. And the case number that you see in the upper right-hand corner corresponds to the case number of this particular case, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Was that document, I'm sorry.
It's filed at the clerk's office?
Well, that was going to be my next question, Your Honor.
Okay.
Was that particular document filed in any form with the clerk's office prior to today?
Yes, certified mail. Okay.
Is that copy a stamp file copy or what we call a service copy that does not yet have a stamp file on it?
This one does not have the stamp file on it.
But it's your recollection that that was filed with the court prior to today?
We have certified mail received that the court received it and I verified it.
And you, that document was submitted so that you could make your claim aware to the court during this process?
On right? March 24th, there were several of us that found out at the last minute because no one's getting proper notice. The majority of victims are not getting any notice. And so we had to dig to find out that there was a March 24th hearing. Judge Hamby was
Let's just hold on for a second. I'm just trying to stick to this document and then we'll move on to everything else you want to talk about.
Well, this was sent by Judge Hamby's instructions.
Okay.
That's where I was going with that.
Right. Your Honor, for purposes of this hearing, I've moved to enter this document in evidence. If there's no objection.
I think we've heard from the court and clerk, it's better just to file it. If you attach an exhibit sticker, then she takes it and it becomes part of the transcript, which I don't think anybody's really going to order the transcript. So I think it's better to file it.
Whatever works best for the court.
Okay. All right. So hand it to Tanya. And I don't mind you going through all of this. Do you know if all of this stuff is, has she ever filed it before? She says she sent it, but she didn't send it to me, obviously. She sends it to the clerk at the court.
Correct.
Do you know whether there's a, have you gone through all this?
I have not had a chance to get it on.
You never got a copy of this, bro. All right, so we're going to file it in the courtroom. And all right, and so what's your next question, of course? Thank you.
All right, thank you, Your Honor. Ms. Michaels, when did you first interact with either Perry Phillips or his office regarding this matter?
He was sent a certified letter that was signed for.
and we never received response.
What was your next step after that?
We didn't know what to do after that. I did follow up with Matt Friedman, trying to find out what was going on, and Mr. Friedman was kind enough to let me know when the next court hearing was. It was upcoming, which was September 2nd.
How many hearings or court appearances prior to the one today that you personally attended?
Two.
And do you remember, just if you know the exact date, great, but do you remember the dates of those particular court appearances?
Yes, sir, March 24th and September 2nd.
Okay. At the March 24th hearing, did you have an opportunity or did you request an opportunity to convey to the court or anybody else involved in this process your feelings or any questions you had about how the process was proceeding at the first hearing?
May I go into a little bit of detail?
Sure. Go ahead.
March 24th, again, many of us found out, I did at the last minute, and I notified some others. We know that Perry Phillips has been intricately involved since 2002, as far back as we can date currently. We gave vehement request that he be denied the receiver position. We gave viable cause.
When you say we, who are you talking about?
There were several others present at the time that Judge Hamby listened to their verbal input, and it was vehement, sir. And we also had affidavits in hand, which we found later he could have taken in at that time under receivership guidelines and protocol. However, we were told that it would not be ruled on until later the following week to give us time to get those things submitted to Judge Flournoy. And indeed, on Monday, Perry Golds was stamped into the receiver position, right, against all objections.
All right. And between that original hearing and the second hearing, I believe in September, what action, if any, did you take?
We copied Judge Flournoy by certified mail, which in receivership protocol is allowed when a creditor or a victim knows that something is wrong or a wrongdoing or potential wrongdoing. And we sent a large packet inclusive of those affidavits to Judge Flournoy by certified mail in June. June 10th was the date on them. And they were received.
Were those affidavits also sent to Perry Phillips' attention?
No, first of all, no one ever told us to communicate with Perry Phillips on March 24th. We were told to communicate directly with the court and to send our proof of claims to the court, marked proof of claim on the outside of the envelope. We did a follow-up phone call with the court to double-check that after March 24th.
And you attended the September hearing, correct?
Yes, sir.
And did you have an opportunity to voice any objections or concerns at that particular hearing? September hearing, the last hearing report.
Can I make a comment leading into that?
Well, I just want you to give your testimony, whatever you think is relevant.
Okay. First of all, it's unbelievable that Perry Phillips is not being allowed to act in the manner that he did September 2nd. September 2nd, I felt verbally assaulted by Perry Phillips. I stood here and tried to talk with Judge Flournoy. I'm not an attorney, I'm not an accountant, but I have had some experience in federal courtrooms. And Perry Phillips was allowed to guffaw loudly in the background.
I really want you to focus on the substance, okay? I understand you have an opinion, and if the court wants to hear all of this, that's fine. I'm just trying to understand, A, did you have an opportunity at the last hearing to voice concerns, and what were they?
I did, yes. Judge Flournoy was kind enough to hear me.
Okay. And what were those briefly?
I made those documents that we had with us on March 24th, the affidavits, and the additional documentations inclusive of those affidavits that were sent by certified mail in June. I had those with me on September 2nd. And I asked Judge Flournoy to please understand the gravity and magnitude of the matter and to take that I wanted to make sure they were a court record. And they were handed to the clerk and stamped and handed to Judge Flournoy.
All right. And as you sit here today and testify, what are your and your mother's estimated damages as a result of this process?
The auction value was $250,000.
And what?
You mean $250,000?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
And what response, if any, have you got from Perry Phillips or his office regarding the disposition of those items?
None.
And have you? And I assume you've tried to contact him and find that out, correct?
We sent the certified letter and received no response.
Okay. And your mother is 85 years old, correct?
Soon to be 86, and I can tell you, sir, and I know this is a side comment again, but I left her this morning crying.
Well, and you're here today. Well, strike that. Was your mother in a position to travel here today?
No.
Okay. And you're here on her behalf?
Yes.
As a member of the family, obviously. Is there anything else you'd like to tell the court?
I have a bit of notes that may take me 3 to 5 minutes, and I'd like to make it a record.
Sure. All right.
I want to go back to the way that I was treated by Perry Phillips in the courtroom on September the 2nd. It was a verbal assault. Judge Flournoy had stepped away for just 2 seconds. And there are witnesses to that. I'm very happy to see that he's acting in a manner of protocol today. The email list that he's referenced, and these are going to be not thoughts that are in exact order, but that is a hand-selected email list that is being sent out.
Yes, ma'am.
And we have verification of that. I also handed to Judge Flournoy again, as we did on March 24th with Judge Hamby, a notice that stated that Four Seasons Auction Gallery had, for over a decade, generated $3 million annually, and that they only had one way to go and up. And the word was used, we, consistently through that email. Again, sorry to be redundant, but we know Perry Phillips has been involved since 2002, if not before. We were able to access these files through court records. So I'm not understanding why Perry Phillips is so confused about who filed a claim and who didn't. These are all open records. They have everyone's contact information and all the claim information. I have talked with numbers of people who have tried to speak with Perry Phillips, and they can later testify, as Mr. Millsaps has, that when trying to speak with him, he either did not tell the truth, and we can prove that as well, and or he became obnoxious and sometimes demeaning, as he did with me on September 2nd. Just a couple more things, please. Regarding the landlord asking to be favored over all other creditors, Mr. McClanahan had allowed Perry Phillips and Steve White to stay in that building for a long time, being owed money. And he made the decision to let them stay. I don't understand why, just because they stayed in there a little bit longer, why he's now allowed to be favored over anyone else. Perry Phillips and Michelle Wilson have violated court orders. They have not acted in correct protocol pertaining to any level of receivership, legal receivership, and honest receivership processes. Perry Phillips is egregiously misrepresenting assets. We've asked for an audit from the very beginning. On March 24th, we began that. We put it in writing. We also stated it again on September the 2nd. Lastly, he never qualified as a viable receiver. He's not a third party, neutral third party. It's very evident. I'm not an accountant, but you can look at the losses, and here are more losses. In addition to the, it is $3.5 million, not 3.9 or whatever you said, or under that. It's $3.5 million if you look at the correct documents. These are another $10 million or so in losses that we know have just disappeared into thin air. Is that what we're to believe? No, these assets have been taken. They've been used for personal benefit and gain, and these victims deserve to have, to be made whole again, including my mother.
Is that all we have, ma'am? I don't have any further questions, subject to cross-examination.
Yes, Mr.
Ms. Wilson has a few questions.
All right.
Ms. Michaels, do you have a copy of the certified letter you gave to Mr. Phillips with you today?
Yes.
May I see it?
It's an original. You'll return it?
I'm not going anywhere. We'll just be presented.
Well, you never know with you guys.
You want me to make a copy of it?
If you don't want.
You said it's an original. I think the original would have been sent to Mr. Phillips, correct? The original would have been sent.
Absolutely.
This is the copy.
This is our copy with the certified receipt.
You're saying this is my only copy. Would you please make a copy of my only copy?
Yes, that's correct. Thank you, sir.
Ms. Michaels, while we're waiting on that, would you mind telling me when you originally filed your proof of claim to the court? Was it earlier than today?
Yes, it was prior to the May 19th deadline as instructed by Judge Hans.
Was it the same one-page claim that you gave us today?
Yes.
Where's the rest of it?
The inventory came separately, and I believe I have a copy of that today as well.
May I see that?
Your Honor, if I may, I believe I have an extra copy of that. I can,
okay. Thank you.
Submit that so she doesn't have to.
Ms. Michaels, how long ago did the claim originate for your mother, the $250,000? Is that recent? Or was that over a period of years?
No, it was a theft by conversion, and I have a copy of a fax from Steve White where it is the same thing that he did to Robert Weinberg, which is a theft by conversion, an unconscionable contract. The items were withheld.
The date.
I'll tell you. The items were withheld for an extensive period of time, and at one time, Mr. Phillips was on the phone with Steve White, my mother and I, and he told us to file a lawsuit.
I'm going to object at this point.
That they will fight as long and as hard as he...
Better finish your little statement.
You're safe.
It is not hearsay. I sat right there and listened to the guy say it to me.
Okay. Well, what the question was, when did your mother's claim originate? So that would be like in 2014. When did she entrust all this? I think you're asking, when did she entrust all of these items to Mr. White?
Perry Phillips and Steve White backed two tractor trailers up to my mother's home in 2010.
About 2010 is when the property went into the hands of Mr. White.
And it was approximately 2012 that Phillips was on the phone with mother and I and a witness. And he said he was obnoxious, as he has been throughout this whole process with other victims as well. And he said, go ahead, sue us. We'll fight you as long and as hard as you can. He knew that mother and I were suffering health issues and that these were our last pennies to survive. And when I spoke about evil being in the courtroom on September 2nd, I don't know how much more evil you can get when you do that to an elderly person, and many victims are elderly.
Why did you wait, Ms. Michaels, until 2016 September, 3 months after the receivership was begun, to hire an attorney if the phone call occurred in 2012?
We went through many gyrations to get these people to return my mother's assets. And in 2012, We were told again, let us look at our books, let me look at the numbers, let me see what's going on. We were put off and put off. And finally, we began to go to the authorities. Mother, I think if you remember me just saying, mother and I were left penniless. We've had a horrible time. These were fines and a very hard decision made, Ms. Wilson, to do this. These items have been withheld under theft by conversion and extortion for these periods of time. We've been continually fighting. In June of 2015, one of the last things we did, thank you, sir, is file a criminal complaint with Forsyth County Sheriff's Department, as did Robert Weinberg. We've been making efforts ever since these things occurred to have mother's assets returned.
You say you were left penniless and you were preparing for the March 24th hearing at the last minute, but yet you had time to hire a private investigator prior to that hearing, did you not?
On March 6th. Was that a lot of time, leeway of time? I don't think so, to find out about a court hearing, especially when people have to come from Virginia, South Carolina, Tennessee, and Alabama. I think that's called interstate. There's also a gentleman in Sweden, so I think that adds foreign.
Madam, you say you hired the private investigator on March 6th, and that wasn't a lot of time, but yet you just admitted that you've had a claim against Mr. White since 2012. That was 4 years.
The gentleman that was engaged as private investigator had to do with other components of this matter that we had discovered just shortly prior to that. I'm not an accountant, but this does not compute at all. And anyone looking at this with any common sense can see that $10 million and then another $3.5 million can't just disappear into thin air. There was an email sent out that said the company had revenues of $3 million annually for over a decade. Where's all of our money? We need our money and our assets back. And this has been so egregiously mishandled. That's why we're here today. Had an audit been done, as is standard in any receivership process, with any honest receiver, had our request for an audit been heard, none of this would be going on right now.
And Ms. Michaels, with what money are we going to do an audit? There's no money to do one with.
That's a lie.
What would you propose?
That's a lie.
And you have evidence of this. Where is the evidence that this is a lie?
Are you an attorney?
Yes, she's an attorney. It's not appropriate for you to ask her questions, Daniel. Do you have any other questions for Ms. Michaels?
Well, Ms. Michaels, you said that there is $10 million in that folder. Over what period of time does that $10 million cover? Is it over several years?
Well, there were a few million, which some is reflected in here, but not in the $10 million that I'm referencing. Prior to the 2007 bankruptcy that Perry Phillips was a creditor in, and then somehow went on to work for Steve White for many years afterward, even fighting a more current claim to the Supreme Court level. How was all that paid for? Where is all that money coming from?
Ms. Michaels.
The 2007 bankruptcy, there were a few million taken prior to that, and then the orchestrated bankruptcy, wherein Neil Gordon, the bankruptcy trustee, said there was Ponzi and bleed out occurring, and then Phillips went on to file an L.R. Barnes LLC in Steve White's very ill mother's name. The bleed out reference was going through the bankruptcy trustee felt, Steve White's infirm mother.
That $10 million covers claims from how far back? What years? I'm asking for years.
Beginning after the bankruptcy.
So 2007?
Yes.
So it covers almost 10 years. Thank you. That's all the questions
Where is it?
Thank you. Any other questions for Mark? Okay, thank you, Ms. Michael. We can step down. Thank you.
Thank you.
Will we call any other witnesses?
Yes. Your Honor, the claimants call claimant Gary Gibbs. Gary Gibbs Jr.?
Right.
Okay.
Now his name's Gibbs, G-I-B-S.
Yes, I'm sorry, I'm moving a little bit slow. I felt like Walmart. No, I'm not together.
Do you want to just sit down right here, or would you like, can you go up the steps? Or?
I think I can go up the steps.
Okay.
Maybe lean on them a little bit.
That's all right.
And raise your right hand and the clerk will administer an oath to
you. You solemnly swear affirm the evidence you shall give to court, and the opinion you shall give the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do.
Please say and swear your name for the court.
Gary M. Gibbs, G-A-R-Y, M. Gibbs, G-I-B-B-S, Jr.
Thank you, sir.
Well, Mr. Gibbs, I think you just gave us your name for the record, so I'm going to get into a little bit of background and then move forward. Where do you reside, sir?
Gainesville, Georgia.
Okay. And you, in fact, are here on your father's behalf, correct?
Correct.
And how old is your father?
Dad is, he's 71.
Okay. And what is your understanding as the family's representative here today as to the items that your father is seeking compensation for?
He's seeking compensation for a 1962 Volkswagen that was bought by my aunt's sister. She was the oldest of 13 children, so she became sister. And it was passed to my granddad and then passed to my dad. Mom said not to sell it, but Dad said we needed the money since I had been shot in the head and robbed.
Well, I wanted you to very, very briefly explain to the court, because I know you have.
Okay, but
I don't want to call it a disability being sensitive, but I want the court to understand that you are in fact competent to give testimony. Okay.
Right.
So quickly tell the court what happened to you, the unfortunate circumstance.
Okay, I'll go ahead and I just got shot in mode. But anyway, Dad took the Volkswagen down to the auction. He had already run the truck through. He got paid with that fine. They were paid $6,000 from a guy in California that had one just like it when he was young. And then we never got any money. We would call and we would get the runaround.
Did you ever call, or are you just going by what your father had told you?
I'm going by what my dad told me.
Okay, all right. But it's you have what we like to call direct knowledge that in fact that particular Volkswagen was entrusted to Steve White at some point to sell.
I think his dad took it down the February 13th, and he sold it on February 21st.
February 13th of this year?
Yes, sir.
February 13th, your father took the car to Mr. White, who was still alive then.
Right.
And you think the car was sold to whom?
Some guy in California. We've got his name in the folder over there.
Okay. Sold to a guy in California.
And he paid with a $6,000 check.
Paid $6,000 even, and Mr. White never gave you your $6,000.
Right. He never gave us anything. And that's really all I know on that.
Your Honor, I apologize for how clunky the document presentation has been here. I can represent the court and certainly show I have a copy of a filed copy of his family's proof of claim.
Well, he's got the clerk of the court.
It does.
File stamped in his part. You don't have to file this.
Okay. I just wanted to, I know it's been a little bit herky-jerky, but I just wanted to represent the court that you have it, and I can certainly show it to them.
And it's for $6,000 even?
Yes, sir. The amount of claim on the proof of claim is $6,000, and it's notarized and signed by his father.
Gary Gibbs.
Same in here.
There you
go. On April 26th of 2016.
Okay.
And there are no other items, sir, that your family entrusted to
see? No, sir.
Do you have anything else you'd like to tell the court?
No, sir, I do not.
All That's all I have for this list.
Thank you so much. Do you have any questions?
No questions.
Thank you so much for coming, Mr. Gibbs.
Okay.
Thank you. Be careful. Any other incidents you'd like to call us to plans?
Your Honor, I know this is somewhat of an unusual proceeding, so I'm going to seek direction from the court because I want to try to be as economical as possible. There are several other folks here.
Can I get that?
Yes, sir. You sure?
Thank you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. There are several other folks here, Your Honor, that I do not represent. I don't know if I will, but they are here as interested parties. They would like.
You know who they are, and you know it's Mary Jones or Bill Wilson or whoever.
I think it'd be quick, so I just called and went through the same line of questioning.
That's fine with me.
They can be cross when you're done rather than them kind of coming up and talking. Might be easier.
It'll be more orderly if you do it that way.
Happy to do it, Judge.
Do you have a list of the people you want to call? And has Heather Slankowitz given you a list? I'm kind of okay. You go ahead.
I'm sorry, Judge. I wasn't sure. I didn't compile a list. I just didn't know which way you wanted to go. What is your name, sir?
Scott Goldberg.
Scott Goldberg?
Yep.
Okay. Please say the same, Mr. Goldberg.
Gold, G-O-L-D, mm-hmm. B-E-R-G.
That's right.
Thank you, sir. Come on up to the witness stand, second chair. Thank you. Raise your right hand. Mr. Mm-hmm. Burke, Mr. Justice.
I'm
Scott Goldberg, G-O-L-D, B-E-R-G.
Mr. Goldberg, where do you presently reside?
In Marietta.
And how did you first come to know Steve White and his auction house?
My dad passed away. We were looking for ways to sell his property. And that seemed to be the biggest operation that we knew of.
And do you recall what specific items you entrusted to Steve White and his company?
We literally had my basement full and a 10x10 storage full. So, I mean, I can tell you, you know, collections of Hollywood memorabilia, baseball cards, figurines. I mean, there were a ton of items.
And did you or anybody on behalf of your father submit what we've been calling a proof of claim?
Yes.
And I know I don't represent you, but I'm going to, as an officer of the court, try and guide you to make this easy for everybody. Do you have a copy of that with you, by any chance?
I did not realize I would be testifying today, so I did not have any of the paperwork, but we do have that material.
And do you know whether or not you or anybody on your behalf ever filed it with the court or sent it to Mr. Phillips?
We did. You sent it filed in the court.
You did file a proof of claim with the clerk's office?
Yes. So,
okay. That's fine.
And that's under the name of?
Should be Scott, or Scott and Judy Goldberg, or Judy and Scott Goldberg. Okay.
And Goldberg, G-O-L-D-B-E-R-G.
Yeah, we're listed in that document there.
Okay, and when you say the document, are you referring to the second reported receiver distributed earlier today?
Yes, that. Right. Our name's on the second page, I believe.
And on that document,
Judy and Scott Goldberg says they're entitled to $59. Is that the number?
That's the number they allege you're entitled to. Do you have any comment on whether or not that number is accurate?
It's not accurate. I mean, the amount of items sold should have been $33,000 based on the report we received before seasons. Well, actually, it was discovered. We took pictures of the pages. But our items sold last year, they're listed as selling this year in May, which is not correct.
Did you or anybody on behalf of your late father reach out to Mr. Phillips or his staff to inquire about the status of receiving compensation for the items sold?
Eventually, when we found out that things were in his control, we did.
And what response, if any, did you receive?
First response was phone call directly to his office, which was, as described, pretty unpleasant. Then, second time, met him at the Four Seasons property to collect whatever material may be found.
And were you ever given information about the whereabouts of any property that had not been sold?
No. According to the papers that we got there that day, everything was sold pretty much, with the exception of, you know, just unframed pictures, like two or three things that we were able to take out of there. But everything else had been done and sold, apparently.
And is this the first hearing you've attended, or have you been to others prior to my involvement?
This is the first hearing.
And is this the first hearing anybody on behalf of your father has attended?
Yes.
And as I've done with the other witnesses, similar procedure and protocol here, is there anything else you'd like to tell the court before I tender you cross-examination?
One thing that I can say is when we were there that day trying to find records, we're told by...
You said that day, what day?
It was, I believe, in...
The day of the auction, by the way?
No, that the last day that the plaintiffs could go into the property and retrieve their material, we had one day to do it.
So like the end of April, maybe?
Yeah, okay.
April 25th?
April 30th.
Excuse me, April 30th, prior to the auction, it was going to occur on May 7th.
Right.
We went up there on April 30th.
Right.
And your mother's...
Me and my wife.
You and your wife, okay.
And we were inquiring about the records to see when it sold, what didn't sell. And we were told by Mr. Phillips that he didn't have access to the computer system, so we couldn't find out. And one of the other ladies that is here today actually discovered the book of record that showed what had sold in the auction. And that's how we found out that things supposedly had sold and what they sold for.
And the information I have is that you were seeking approximately $32,255.
Right.
$32,255, that's the amount listed on his proof of claim.
I believe so.
And that was all total based on what the auction items listed as selling for in total.
And those, that auction occurred prior to the May 7th, you're talking about?
Yes, last year.
You said last year, which implies to me it would have been in 2015.
Right.
And it would have been while Mr. White was still alive.
Right.
So he sold stuff while he was alive, and whatever he got for it, he never remitted you any money.
Right. I spoke to Steve White, and he said, yeah, you'll be receiving a series of checks. And nothing came, so we started calling.
Okay. And you just never got anything.
You're right.
Okay.
Sir, now, would you like that?
I think that is it.
Thank you for your time.
Just really quick, I wanted to confirm your consignor number is 6284.
That sounds correct, but I can't, you know, guarantee that. I don't know exactly, but it sounds right.
Okay. Thank you.
Anybody else? Any other witnesses?
Yes, Your Honor. These should move fairly quickly. Kay Anderson, please come forward. And that's K A Y.
No,
just
letter K.
Oh, the letter
K. Yeah. Period. Y.
I say it correctly. The letter K.
K. Okay. That's fine.
It's K, just the letter K, no period, no Y, Anderson, A-N-D-E-R-S-O-N.
Thank you.
Ms. Anderson, where do you reside?
Marietta, Georgia.
And have either you or any member of your family, is it concerns or claims in this matter, ever attended any prior hearings before today?
No, sir, I'm here on behalf of my husband.
What is his name?
Don Anderson.
And just so we can understand, what is the reason why Mr. Anderson can't be here?
He has moved to Canada.
I see. Do you recall whether or not either you or Mr. Anderson submitted what you've heard referred to as a proof of claim in this matter?
I have a copy of a proof of claim, I believe, that he had mailed to Mr. Phillips.
Would you mind please reading me the consignor number if it's on there? If you have that information from another source.
Because I'm not going to go on here. I have a claim. I have a consignor number.
That's fine. What date was that proof of claim dated?
April 14th.
And what is the amount sought in that proof of claim?
He only put $2,500, but there's actually more than that that went to auction, but he only put a claim of $2,500. It's more than $5,000.
And what items is he seeking compensation for?
He collected antique coins. We had a whole book of antique coins, banknotes back from old banknotes. What do you call them? Pan Am stock certificates, all kinds of stock certificates that had expired. We had. License plates, which I know is not silly to people, but they're very expensive. Some of them are from the early 1900s, were hard to get. Some cost several thousand dollars. Road signs, antique road signs. He had a lot of old tools. We had a chest. Just yard equipment, all kinds of things went to this auction. At the time, I was ill. I was recovering from an organ transplant operation. So I was not with it to help try to go through stuff.
At any point, did you personally interact at all or attempt to interact at all with Mr. Phillips at this firm?
Yes, I went to his office and took my power of attorney. I took some other things that he had asked. I spoke with him. I also spoke with his secretary. And I talked with him on the phone a couple of times.
And what was discussed?
About the auction. And he just said that they needed to discuss things with me, the power of attorney. And that they would let me know and let us know when things would have been sold. Before that, my husband had tried to get in touch with the Mr. White, the auction house, and the phone just rang, or it wouldn't pick up. And he sent emails, and finally he got notification, I'm not sure from who, that Mr. White had passed away. And that's when I believe he got in contact with Mr. Phillips.
And other than that, is there any other communication or interaction with Mr. Phillips or his firm that you're aware of?
I don't know if Don has contacted him.
If you don't know, you don't know. I'm just asking if you know. Right. What about you? Any further communication from you directly with Mr. Phillips or his firm about this matter?
I've called him a couple of times, checking on some things, and they would tell me then to go to the website and look on the website that everything was there.
And what did you find? Well, let me back up. Did you in fact go to the website to investigate what would be there?
I just referred my husband to that, since that was his deal. Since that was his, that he would be more apt to understand and to see what all was going on for him to handle that.
And approximately, what is the amount of damages sought to prove the claim as we sit here today?
Well, he put on here $2,500, but like I said, it's more than that. But he put on the proof of claim $2,500.
Why do you say it's more than that?
Pardon?
Why do you say it's more than
that? Because I know the value of the things that he took. I personally know the value. And I know that when we purchased them, they were more than $2,500.
Is there anything else you'd like to tell Judge Flournoy?
Just not getting the money. It's a hardship. Sorry.
You're fine.
That's all I have this morning.
Okay, thank you.
Let's call Lisa Hammond, please, to the stand up. Ms. Hammond, where are you currently residing?
Fayetteville, Georgia.
And prior to today, have either you or anybody else on behalf of the estate, I believe, of James W. Hammond, appeared in court before for this matter?
No, it's actually Hamlet, H-A-M-L-E-T-T.
Okay, I'm sorry. Thank you for that correction. Yes. And what is your relation to that particular person?
He was my uncle. He's passed away.
Her name is Hammond, but the uncle is Hamlet.
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay.
Like the Shakespeare play? Okay. And can you describe for me, please, what particular items were entrusted to Steve White and his auction house out of that estate, to your knowledge?
Well, we had a lot, quite a number of, as it was referred to before by someone, junk. But to us, it was not junk. It was,
what is that document you're holding? That might
this,
help.
This is the list
okay. Of
items.
Do you know if that was submitted to the court at any point?
Don't know.
Is there a proof of claim document in that packet?
No, that was done by my lawyer, and I did not really think I was going to be up here today, so I do not have that.
And who is your attorney?
Crystal Boudreau of Sinaway, Georgia.
And did Ms. Boudreau know about today?
She did not. Again, I thought this, didn't realize I was going to be here.
Are you comfortable testifying without her being here?
Yes.
Okay. I'm sorry, let me one more time. Your lawyer's name was Crystal
Boudreau.
B-O-U-D-R-E-A-U-S. And she was from where?
Sinaloa,
Georgia. Thank you.
And to be clear, you've never met me before today, correct?
Right.
And you're here in and of your own free will.
Yes.
And you want to proceed and testify as to what you know about this?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. If you could proceed, please, and describe, I know it looks like a lot of items, but if you could as succinctly as possible, describe the items that were transmitted to Mr. White and his company.
There were things such as an antique harp and case, probably 300 years old maybe. Mostly antiques, really all antiques. Things, from his collection. And we're trying to, liquidate that estate and be done with it.
Right. And when did you first interact with Perry Phillips or his law firm?
When I found out from a family friend who knew we were working with Four Seasons, he saw it on the news that he had committed suicide. So we began to do a little homework and, find that he was associated with it. So I called and talked to Lucia Mattern, and she told me to send him an email and that someone would get back with me. Back in March.
And has anybody gotten back in touch with you since March?
I did send a certified letter requesting several times. My lawyer also requested. We never got this list. This is the contract we had with Steve White. He filled it out with us back in December of 15. And he never put a consignment number or anything like that on it. So when they came to pick up our stuff in December of 2015, the man who came to pick it up told my brother, who was there, he was making a list.
What is your brother's name, ma'am?
Brad.
Last name. Oh, thank you.
That he would, take this list back, get it prepared, and get him a copy of it. But he did not do that. So after it had been several weeks after the auction, I believe it was a January 3rd auction of 2016, he called Mr. White and he said, "Oh yeah, we had the auction. We're just getting the paperwork finished up. We still never got this copy." He's like, "We'll get back with you with your win and your proceeds or whatever." Never heard from him. Then found out he killed himself. So, but all along I've been asking for this list because I cannot put an amount on it until I see the list. This was like, for some reason, we were just having a real hard time getting this list from anyone. And I knew that when we got notice to come pick up our stuff on April 30th, we had, I believe it was 10 to 2. I've got all this in my paperwork and emails also. When we were supposed to come, I think we had 4 days notice to come pick up our stuff on April 30th. And I knew there was a lot of stuff, and no one was getting me a list. So,
and to be precise, when in fact did you get that list?
I got this list on April 30th.
And you had how many days from that point?
I got it actually the day I went. So I didn't know what I was going to be up against. So I got as many people as I could come help me. We had two pickups and two flatbed trailers, thinking we were going to have a lot of stuff. And so when I got there, I too, just like Mr. Goldberg, asked Mr. Phillips for a copy of the list. I have to have the list to know, you know, what to look for and to see what sold and what didn't. When I got there, he said that he could not pull up that information. He didn't have any employees, any way of pulling up that information. So, you know, we were just left on our own. And then later in the course of the day, somehow my sister was able to talk to a lady that was working up at the counter, and she produced a book. And in the book was copies of the list. So she texts me, and I'm out in the warehouse searching around for anything that looks familiar.
Do you know who that lady was, by any chance?
I don't know for sure who she was.
You
recall the name? No one I know. Possibly, for some reason we were under the impression that it could possibly be Mr. Phillips' wife, but that is just totally...
You don't know who it was.
I can't even say that for sure. But there was another lady there who, once we began, like, they didn't have a copy machine, so all I could do was start snapping pictures with my cell phone. And there was another lady who seemed a little uneasy about the fact that we were doing this. Like I said, you know, maybe that was, I don't know if that impression was correct, but that is the feeling that we got, that we should not be doing what we were doing. I don't know why. But having this list has been a huge help. Now, I did get an email with my name on it, and it had your amount, I guess, your proof of claim amount.
Right.
And mine was left blank. But I know now, by adding up all the things that sold, that it should be $26,832.
Okay.
I've not gotten a check for 59 or 12 or 14 or anything, but...
Is there anything else you'd like to tell the court?
Just, you know, I feel like I personally, when I first contacted Mr. Phillips, well, actually, when he returned my phone call, I too felt as if I was bothering him. I got the feeling that he was, I was taking up his time, that kind of impression. I also feel like when we went to the, I will say when my lawyer called him and asked for this list, she also made the statement that he was not very helpful to her. When we got to the auction on April 30th, or to the auction house, it wasn't auction, to the warehouse, you know, I got that, again, that defensive kind of tone that, you know, he could not help us, would not help us. You know, there was no help for us, I guess. And but then the tone did change as the day went on. There wasn't many people there, for one thing. Not like I thought there would be. I thought we would just be bombarded with people and activity. There wasn't a whole lot. There wasn't nearly the amount of things in the warehouse, I thought, just overall. But we searched and searched just because we weren't going to leave any leaf unturned for our items. A lot of the items, for whatever reason, like once we had found this list with our consignor number on it, so we, you know, kind of knew what to look for, some of the items that we saw of ours that we knew were ours, we knew beyond a shadow of a doubt, because we've been dealing with this estate for a long time, had a different number on it. So I don't know what that was about. But if it was ours, we put it in the truck, and we maybe had maybe one pickup. I don't know. Maybe a pickup truck worth of stuff. Not a lot. And I would say I feel like we could have taken anything in that warehouse. There was really no one to stop us. Not that we did, but I felt like we could, you know what I mean? Like, not that, you know. There was, you know, it was just, it was weird.
That's all I have to say, sure.
Can she step down? Do you have any questions?
Just a couple questions, Judge.
You could do that up there if you want.
You don't recall taking at least two truckloads and possibly a trailer with some items on that same day?
We had two trucks and two trailers with us because we thought we had a lot of stuff to take. No, there was a couple of pieces to a bed. I think we did put on the back of the truck because they were long. They didn't fit on the bed of the truck, so we put them on the flatbed. Yes, I think we did.
And you don't remember being checked out at the exit when you left with the items?
So the questions I have, Judge. I'm sorry, just say yes or no.
No.
I have no further questions at this point, Judge.
I think you can step down, Ms. Hammond.
Your Honor, I believe I have one more witness. Okay. Claimant's called Brian Nolan. Is he?
Last name's Nolan.
Nolan. N-O-L-A-N.
Right hand, show them, Mr. President.
Okay. I'm solemnly swear affirm that the evidence you shall be supporting which you can tell me the truth, and I will take the nothing but the truth. Please say this word in the report.
Yeah, it's Brian, B-R-I-A-N, Nolan, in a woman here.
Thank you, sir.
I don't need the address. You live in Gwinnett County?
Yeah.
Here in Georgia?
Okay.
And at any point throughout this process, have you or anybody on behalf of the items at issue in your particular case submitted what we've been calling a proof of claim?
Yes. You got that number?
If you could, well, let's do one or two.
Oh, let me tell you first what I did. I got a, this was done by, they call them stamps of
Notary Public.
Yeah, and this is the proof of claim. And then I also have the number that was on
the consignor number.
Yes.
So can you please read that in the record form? Claim is on your behalf, not on the behalf of an overrated or somebody's deceased. Okay, it's your items.
Okay.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. And please describe for the court what particular items you entrusted with Steve White and Four Seasons.
Sure. Well, you know, when we itemized it, there were, there were 21 items. There were some tools. There was china, silver, and crystal. That's primarily the items. I've got pictures of all the items here with the their value, and like I said, I did turn it into the court, and he doesn't remember, but I handed it to him. He was a nice guy, and maybe he was at lunch.
Okay. What is the approximate value of the items that you entrusted to you?
Yeah, well, I don't have the total because I didn't get compensated a small amount for some of the items, but regarding the other, it was $6,718.
So you did accept payment for some of the value?
Yes.
What amount of money did you already accept?
$518.
So what amount would you ask the court here today in terms of the value?
That was the 67 number that I just gave.
So 67, not 67 less 500?
No, in addition to.
Understood, okay. You kind of jumped ahead of my next question, but just to get an order in the record.
Sure.
Obviously you had an interaction with Mr. Phillips, you just described for us. Do you recall when and where that was?
In his office. Well, actually, it was in the entryway of the various offices in the old Cobb building.
And you handed them one again?
I have a packet that looked like this.
Other than that interaction, have you had any other interactions since then with either?
No, for some reason I was getting emails regarding the estate before this was due, and then since then I haven't gotten any emails further giving me information. You know, this court proceeding was being held, or my previous one was being held.
Is this the first court proceeding you've been to?
That's right.
Is there anything else you'd like to tell the court?
Sure. First off, I do want to tell you that after I had given my goods to Steve White, they must have had an unannounced auction, because I can't remember what alerted me to that, but I came up to the auction house to see you know what it was all about, or maybe get a check. I don't remember, again, like I said, how I became aware there was this auction. But it appeared to me by the things that the people were saying that there was a private auction done, and it was done with I want to call it his cronies, some of his cronies came.
Whose cronies?
Steve White's.
Okay.
Because I had the same problem, in other words, that somebody else mentioned. Well, I don't remember what it was. Sorry, I'm disabled, so just bear with me a little bit.
Sure.
Okay, so anyway, I came up there, and I looked at the list of the items that had sold and what they'd sold for, and I was devastated. So I went to him and I explained, you know, this is all I've got from, you know, any heirlooms or inheritance or anything like that is not tied up in this. And I guess he felt sorry for me, or he wanted to get me out of his office because I found him back in the back. But so I said, I explained that to him, and he said, well, all right, you can come and pick up whatever is left of your stuff. In addition to that, when I came to pick those items up, they sold I had it evaluated, a $600 ring for $20, and that went to the guy, his name's Ty, and he's the one that did the evaluations of the metal, silver, gold, anything that came in. So, and because it was some sort of private auction, you know, I didn't have all the names of the people, but those two rings were the only things that I was able to retrieve from that first auction that took place. And that's what amounts to the, well, no, that's not what, that's exclusive of what I mentioned right here. And shortly after that, I got a call from from somebody with the licensing board for auctioneers in Macon, Georgia, and she told me that Steve White was under investigation as to whether he should keep his license or not, and asked me to relay my story. And I told him about what I just told you here, and I also to reiterate that other person's comment, the place was wide open. Anybody could come in there and take anything, and nobody would have the first thought. And that's what I wanted to follow up on the other lady. I know. When I came to pick up the stuff, we went over this listing, like here, and we determined which items I was picking up. Well, there were some that weren't sold, and wasn't there to pick up. They were on the list there, and I asked how that could be, because they were very meticulous in the way they kept their records. I mean, she went item by item. I watched them sign all the stuff in and so on. They had a lot of employees also. I can't imagine at a time of an auction that stuff just went missing. And she says, well, don't worry about that because after 3 or 4 weeks, we'll find out what really was sold. And so I had seen a lady, she was a doll lady, just dumped dolls, and I had a very, well, an antique doll. And so I believe that was another one of his cronies that came and bought these items at a lower price than a general auction that was announced and so on. So I told all this to the, oh, I know. So I didn't understand why there were these items that weren't, they weren't there, they weren't sold, and they had to wait 4 weeks. Because of the doll lady, that was it. She seemed to be taking dolls and putting them in her car. And I got the impression that some of the stuff, again, was either given to these experts, the supposed experts, to go and try to sell and then come back and put down a number as if it were an auction. Or they would go run them through another auction or give them back to the customer or whatever. So there was a lot of strange dealings with there, and I was glad to be done with it, but also I was worried about these very expensive and precious things that that had been passed down from my family were essentially just lost. So I guess, let's see. Oh, I was going to file a small claims court suit, but then I got the communication that this proceeding was going on and that I would have to wait for this to culminate and finish before I could file a suit, small claims court. So that's why I'm here today.
Appreciate your time. No further questions.
Question?
Oh, yeah. Go ahead.
Mr. Mullen?
Nolan.
I just wanted to get an email address for you, sir.
BANOLAN.
Okay.
52@gmail.com.
I just wanted to ask you real quick, the private auction you were talking about and the doll lady experience, those were experiences that you had before Steve died?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, am I allowed to ask Perry?
Mr.
Perry?
Perry?
Huh?
What question do you have?
I can ask. I was just wondering in terms of when you first became aware that these claims were so far apart between what was claimed and what actually existed. When did you first become aware of that big discrepancy?
Well, I wouldn't have known until...
I'm sorry, I can't hear you. Do you mind?
He wants to know, when did you first discover that the assets were only $30,000 and the claims were $3 million?
Well,
just roughly.
Okay, well, until everyone filed their proofs of claim, I had no idea what people claimed that they had not been paid.
You hadn't been doing some tally along the way?
Well, there's no way for me to know.
Until they filed their proofs of claim.
Yeah. And okay. So, and then with respect to the value of the items, again, it's an auction. And people who are buying and selling at the auction are the ones that determine the value of those items.
It could have brought $150,000 to the auction, whereas in fact, it only brought $35,000.
Well, I think as you mentioned, Ron, in the last hearing, that you actually asked about a baby grand piano. And there was a baby grand piano. And I think originally the purchase price is $45,000 to $50,000. And I think it brought $4,000, maybe at that much. It's an auction.
The customer of Mr. White's doing business as this Four Seasons Auction House thought that his piano would bring $40,000 or $50,000 at auction, and in fact, it only brought $4,000.
Well, I don't know that he thought that. I just know that people were looking at it, said it's probably worth that. The problem is,
it
doesn't bring it. And there were other people that were in that business, and they says, I've got one sitting in my auction house. People don't buy baby grand pianos.
I understand.
All right, so, and I heard somebody mention before that that part of your purview, or it was a lawyer, part of your purview was to conduct an audit, especially if you saw that kind of discrepancy.
You didn't have any money. Nobody has any money. If you would like to pay for an audit, then Mr. Phillips would gladly have you hire an accountant to do that.
Okay. Well, my thought...
There's no money. I mean, you see
there is very little, but if that $32,000 given to an accountant would find out where that other millions went, wouldn't that be a good for that?
It's not $32,000. It's only $21,000.
Okay, sorry. Anyway, whatever was left, to ask the court to use that to make sure that the money was allocated properly.
Okay. Well, that's your suggestion. I need to cut you off, Mr. Miller. Really, if you want to talk to him later, that's fine. But we really don't have time for you to go on and on about that.
All right. But can I understand who this Barnes is?
Uh-huh. It was a limited liability company that was formed by Mr. Steve White, and it did business as Four Seasons Auction Gallery of Forsyth.
And who is Barnes then?
I think Miss Barnes was his mom, wasn't it? Uh-huh. He used his mother's name. Apparently his mother was probably in the auction business too.
She was actually a member, and then she died.
She died. And then L.R. Barnes was his mother, like Linda or Renee Barnes.
Lorena
Barnes. That was who L.R. Barnes was.
Very strong. Thank you. We do have one more witness, Your Honor. I apologize. I misspoke earlier. I skipped past their name. Dennis Whitlinger. Yeah. Please tell him to stand.
We're going to have him spell that, Judge.
That's not my name.
Gotcha. That's what I was going to write, but I just said
there's no E between the
two. You raise your right hand, please. You solemnly swear affirm the affidavit you shall give to the court that you should be telling the truth, the whole truth, and the whole truth. I have been. Please say it's February 5th.
Dennis Whitlinger, W-H-I-T-L-I-N-G-E-R.
Thank you.
And Dennis is his first name. What was the last name I could?
Whitlinger.
W-H-I-T-L-I-N-G-E-R.
L-I-N-G-E-R.
Whitlinger.
Okay.
I think that's my idea.
All right, Mr. Whitlinger. Where do you presently live?
Jueytown, Alabama.
I've never heard of that. Where is that near?
West of Birmingham, about outskirts of Birmingham, I will say.
And you took time out of your day to travel, I assume, 2.5-3 hours
yes.
to the courthouse today to speak to the judge?
Yes.
And at any point did you or anybody on your behalf submit what we've been calling a proof of claim in this matter?
No, I have not.
Okay. Why is that?
Because by my emails I got from Attorney Phillips, I had to submit my paperwork to the courts, and I filed that last or May or something, whatever, through my attorneys over in Uetown. I've got that paperwork, so I don't have it, but I am in the docket there where I submitted it to the Supreme Court.
If his lawyers filed the proof of claim with the clerk's office, it's in the file.
Yeah, that's all I'm trying to say.
You have to bring it with
you. Don't have to bring
it
with
you. That's why I'm just trying to understand if the claim was filed. And you believe one way or the other, correct?
What's that?
You believe, as you sit here today, that your lawyers submitted paperwork to the court?
Yeah.
Okay.
Like I said, I got the paperwork.
That's fine. No problem. It's in the record that's been filed, so we'll move forward. What particular items had you entrusted to Mr. White in his auction?
Well, I took them up to him August 30th of last year, in which his paperwork says he's going to sell on September 13th of last year. And all I got sold was 12 items. Let's see.
12 items out of 50 items? How much did you
trust? 100 items.
100 even items, okay.
Yeah, there were 100 items. I've got them all right here on paperwork, but it's too long.
So,
I got pictures of everything too.
Right.
Yeah, so I don't know what all got sold. Like I said, I got less than $300 from it.
I'm sorry.
And I'm sorry for everybody else. Really got messed up in this mess, but I'm not as bad as you guys. I just lost about $5,000, so I'm not as bad as the rest of these folks.
Did you receive?
It sounds like his grievance with Mr. White occurred before Mr. White died.
Yes.
Okay. Excuse me, go ahead.
That's fine. It's over here. Of course. As we sit here today, what is the value of items that you are seeking compensation for?
If I bought everything like a brand new, it'd be about $25,000. Auction-wise, I've worked at a lot of auctions, I've been to a lot of auctions, about $5,000.
So some of the items were sold and some obviously were not?
Yeah, baseballs. And
did you get money for the items that were sold? Did Mr. White remit you a check for $800?
No, it was $151.
So he didn't write you a check for $151?
And a check for $73.50.
Thank you. One for $151 and one for $73.50.
Yeah, well, $151.50 and $73.50. That's all I've got.
Okay.
Out of everything on this list.
And have you had any direct interactions with Mr. Phillips or his office?
Yes.
Please describe this for the court.
Everything that's on these papers right here got faxed to him on March the 4th of 16 this year.
Okay.
So what all I got, and see if I got any money coming to me from any of the sales. And that's all the further I got with it. And then my next email from him, or whoever put it on the computer, down there that's going to probate court. I have faxed everything to probate court. I don't remember the dates. Like I said, I have my paperwork to tell you. So I went to my attorneys and they filled it out. It cost me $225 just to send it there and have it certified that they got it.
And did your lawyers ever convey to you one way or the other if Mr. Phillips responded to their attempts to speak with him about this?
Like I said, if I had that paperwork, I could tell you.
I understand, but do you recall them having to tell you either verbally in a phone call or an email?
No, they just sent the paperwork to the Superior Court.
They did what she asked them to do. And your lawyers. And that's it.
I was going to get down with an attorney to come over here, but he said we can't go state to state.
I
had to come over here and get an attorney. From that one I got, it's not really worth getting an attorney because, like, after hearing what money's left, there's no sense to be fighting for a little bit of money.
Is there anything else you'd like to talk about?
Yes, I like to wonder why I'm not on this list.
On what list?
People that get money and don't get money.
Is that the receiver's report you received earlier today?
Because your agreements with Mr. White occurred before he died. What happened is Mr. Phillips was appointed the receiver to try to straighten out what property still was in possession of the Four Seasons Auction House at the time of his death, okay? And then those things, people were notified, come and get your stuff if you want to get it back. And the second thing was, people who didn't get their stuff were going to conduct a grand auction on May 7th. And hopefully, we pray that we're going to raise $500,000 on May the 7th. Didn't happen though, did it? Only raised $35,000.
Hey, see, that's where I got the email on the day of. My wife don't have my computer that much.
I'm sorry.
I'm computer illiterate.
Okay,
so I don't get on.
But his main function, that is Mr. Phillips' main function, was to deal with people that still had property upon his death. You said
everything on his papers, except for 12 items.
To be clear, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but to be clear, I understand what the judge is saying. He had some interactions with Mr. White and had nothing to do with Florida today. But so we're clear before you get off the stand. There are items that your lawyers submitted a proof of claim for.
No.
There are not.
Sent the paperwork, but with everything in here, to the courts. They sent all these papers right here to the courts.
Okay.
And
but there are items that you're testifying,
but
you have not received compensation for.
I didn't, like I said, this is the first time I've ever been to something like this, so I didn't know. I was just letting everything go through the auctions,
and you're
not getting some money out of it.
And you did. You got $151.
I got that last year.
I understand.
Before he died.
Before he died, exactly.
So, my wife suggested I come over here and get my 2 cents worth, and that's what I'm doing.
He entrusted the stuff back on August 30th, 15th. There was an auction on September 13th. Of all the 100 items, he's only 12 sold, and they only raised $151.73. What I don't understand is why you didn't retrieve at that point in time your 88 items that were still there. Why do you say, give me back my 88 items, you only sold 12?
Because the day that I could come over here.
No, the day you went over there, you said you went on September 13th.
I finally had to call them.
We've already had the auction.
And they said, oh, we've been trying to get a hold of you, but we didn't know how. I said, my phone number's right there.
Okay, that's Steve. You're talking about Steve, but he's still alive.
Whoever I talked to, there's a woman that works for Steve. Okay. I said, wait, my phone number's right there, my email's right there. And it was two months after the auction, before I finally got my money. Okay. Then after that, I figured, then all of a sudden, next thing I know, April or March, whatever it was, right after he died.
Right, okay.
And that's when I waited, and then all of a sudden, the day I was supposed to pick stuff up, it was noon before I found out I'd come over here and get my stuff.
Did you come over on April
3rd? It's a 3-hour drive.
So you didn't buy? Okay.
Yeah, so
okay,
that's fine. Then it said, if you don't show up, everything's going to an auction. Okay. So I entrusted them to, like I said, go to the auction and try to get some more money.
Okay.
And
any other questions?
I think that clears up mine.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. You can step in. Okay. Do you have any
questions? Well, first of all, I wanted to let Mr. Whitlinger know that I believe he's looking at the second report of the receiver, where your name is not listed.
Correct.
And I have a list of payments, and I wanted to let him know he is listed, item 66 for $5,000, consignor number 6202.
Okay. Like I said, if I get a little bit of this, pay my gas coming over here and back up. I knew I won't get much, but got anything.
Can you tell me the name of the attorney who filed on your behalf, just so we can follow up on that?
Attorney Clinton Ritchie of Hueytown Roads with this address. I don't know the exact number.
Oh, that's okay. I just probably figured out. Yeah. Thank you.
Yes. Yeah, Clinton Ritchie. That's me.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, you can set him back.
I don't have any witnesses.
No other witnesses. So now the hearing is, do you have any rebuttal witnesses?
Don't worry. I can address what I was about to say. I already addressed it for the lady from last time. And I'm sorry for the other folks about what it was.
Well, tell them that you've not stolen any money. Yeah. You don't have a Porsche at home.
Yes.
You don't have. Go ahead and tell them.
Okay.
Your Honor, I know this has been a.
I think we're calling him as a rebuttal witness, is what it is. Are you calling him as a rebuttal? Or?
Your Honor, we wanted to, I guess, redirect to, in a rebuttal witness, yeah, to rebut some of the statements that were made.
He's rested. You've rested now, correct, Mr. Kleiner?
Do you have any more?
No, I don't have any more witnesses now.
You do have more witnesses.
I do not.
Okay, so you've rested, and so the evidence for you is closed. And so now what happens is Ms. Michelle Wilson, if she wants to, she can call some other witnesses.
Sure, I understand that.
Excuse me. And so she's awaiting to call Mr. Phillips. Is that correct, Ms. Wilson?
Yes, Your Honor.
I just want to not have a seat. You've already been sworn.
Mr. Phillips, would you please explain to the court and to the folks who are here exactly when you actually became receiver and became acquainted with Mr. White's business?
Well, I mean, I did represent Mr. White for a number of years, but I wasn't involved in his business. As part of representing him, I would have to get a consignment agreement and records of certain things if that was an issue in the case. As I said, sometimes I actually was involved in writing bad check letters when people actually bought stuff at the auction, so I would get an auction. Information from Mr. White, copy the check, and we do the bad check letter. So I've never been to Ms. Michael's house or her mother's house. I have never been in a tractor trailer with Steve White anywhere to pick up anything.
That's not what I said.
No, hold on.
Well, that's exactly what she said.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. So I'm in I was not aware of Ms. Michael's claim, per se. I don't heard a statement about being involved in the phone call. I was involved in the phone call. I recall, I know that after Ms. Michael's, Mr. White died, I saw copies of letters that she sent, but I never was asked to be involved in that letters in response to anything that she ever saw. So, as I said, Mr. White died on February 25th. And the very next day, I'm pretty sure of that, there was a notice posted on the door that I was the attorney for Four Seasons. And it was also put up on the website. And it says, sorry to tell you this about the passing of our owner. If you have any questions, please call. I was inundated with phone calls. I mean, I couldn't do anything else but answer phone calls from people. I scheduled a meeting and went up to meet up at Four Seasons with people with Linda Bentley and some other people that were involved that weren't employees of Four Seasons, just to get a handle on what we had in terms of bills, bank accounts, how they kept their records, that kind of stuff. And then said, well, you can't do anything. And in fact, the landlord had actually come out there and changed the locks. Once he heard Mr. White was dead, he changed the locks to basically lock it down, because he knew he was the only person who had actually any authority to operate on behalf of and so he locked the doors to kind of protect the assets as well. And so, and that after that, you know, then I began, there were like 14 cars that were in there, and then to get rid of that, try to get a sense of all the stuff. And I asked how the record keeper was. And it wasn't until the day of April the 30th, when people were coming up to retrieve your stuff, that someone else who had actually worked there, and I don't know who actually identified and said this is what it is, but they actually said if you take out the consignment books, you can actually look behind the consignor, and there's a list of if the items that they would bring, and they would have a pen written down, and if any monies had been paid for when it was sold. And so they had a list of that. So as a result of that, a lot of the people who were there, who were asking about where all their stuff was, the books were pulled out. It's true, we had a copy machine that would not work, so we couldn't make copies of it. Some people, I actually got emails from them and said, you know, I'll be happy to make copies of our list. As a matter of fact, the folks that invested $2 million claim, they had like 20-some-odd pictures, 20-some-odd pages. And so I actually got their email address and took it with me back to my office and copied it and scanned it in an email protection.
You said there's some people that have $2 million?
There's one lady that filed a $2 million claim. That's
one lady filed a $2 million. She's not here today.
No. But she was there the first day I got there, and she picked up a bunch of stuff the day on April 30th, Miss Hamilton, I think, or we got Hamilton, did I get it right? Hamilton. And I remember her and her sister who did testify. Matter of fact, I had an action with her as well. And I believe they were actually, her sister actually took copies, actually took them out of the book and went somewhere else and got a copy. And so that may have been the reason for a little bit of consternation in terms of the fact that we've got records walking out the door. And so I'm running around the whole warehouse. With respect to the way, in terms of stuff, and I'm dealing with all, Your Honor, with what happened after I and the auction.
I understand the grievance that Mr. Woodland there had was 3 days.
Exactly. But also addressing the fact about the thing, you know, that we had one front door, we had a front door that they could go through, and we had people that basically, when they first got in there, they had signed in saying who they were, showing a picture ID, and if they had a consignment agreement, so that I knew that they actually had a bona fides to say that they actually had property there. And then they would say, where's their stuff? And I said, I don't know where your stuff is.
You can walk around and look.
And so they either carried out the front door, and so there I had people there that were checking to make sure they ain't hauling a bunch of stuff. Now, there's a bunch of stuff, but there's a warehouse with truck doors, okay? And so what we did was, but you still only go out one way. And so I either sat there or I had another person sit there to check their paperwork when they came out. Now, and so that was the only way that, we knew to be able to lock it down, because it was chaos. There were a lot of people there. And there were people saying, as I think Ms. Hamilton said something about her item that, were mismarked. And I said, well, I don't have any control over that. And I believe that Dr. Blayden has too many issues, so there were some items that were mismarked there. And so I said, well, again, I only have what's the way it's marked. I don't have any control over that. And but obviously, you know, you sort of claim it is, if it's your property, then let me know, and we'll do that. So that's the way I handle it. Now, with respect to all the folks, again, I am sorry that every one of you, I don't care, I mean, I've got calls. I got a call from a guy that sold a car, and he had everything in it, and he was expecting to get that to pay his rent, and it was going to be dispossessed. And we're talking, it was only a $7,000 car. He was going to lose. He and his family were going to be kicked out. I had a number of people that this is everything that I had. And so I told him, I'm sorry, but I don't have the money to give. But it got to the point where everyone that I was being attacked, but why don't you know where the money is? And so the better way to know exactly what's happening and what's transpiring, so that everybody gets all the information, was please follow the rules that are set forth in the court orders, file the proof of claims, give me your email address, even if you call me, send me an email so that I have your email address, because I'm underlying with the fact that I'm putting it down. But by having an email address, I can capture all that and create that database. I don't know why the gentleman back there is not getting emails. So again, I'm sorry. A lot of people lost a lot of money, and I know a lot of people are upset at Steve, but I wasn't involved in running the business. I did the best I could afterwards. I would have liked that there had been $500,000 sitting in the bank. I would have liked that there was assets worth that. I would have liked to have been able to do an audit. I just didn't have the funds, and I think it would be a breach of my obligation to spend the money that I did collect as a result of the auction to turn around, because I've got several lawsuits right now. I paid auditors $30,000, $50,000 for looking for stuff, and we're only talking about stuff $1 million worth of stuff, not, you know. So I just didn't see it as being a dollar well spent to do that and not give anything to anyone.
All right, and so any other questions for Mr. Phillips?
Just one more. Mr. Phillips, would you please, Ms. Hammond, I think, spoke about her attorney and what her attorney was able and not able to get from us on September 2nd. Would you please explain to the court what you offered to Ms. Hammond's attorney when we were in court last?
Yeah, so apparently the attorney was here, Your Honor, it was Mr. Dzikowski and another attorney from the state. I didn't even call it was their attorney, but I offered, she wasn't there. There's a different attorney. Okay. Every attorney that's called me, I've gotten in touch with them. I do know for a fact.
I can't understand what she's saying from there.
That's not working. Yeah, or what here.
Yeah, I was not. I wasn't even aware of the list until they referred me. So
that's all the questions.
All right. How do you propose that we divide up the $22,115 remaining? What do you want me to do?
My proposal is, we get half to the landlord.
One half to the landlord, okay.
And then
that would leave $11,000,
give or take. Uh-huh. And then what I'm going to have to do is basically, I think it's not prudent for me to send out a check for more than $1. So I think I've got to really cut off any claims that would result in compensation to them for less than $1. Even if I can, I don't believe I'm going to do that last week.
And you want to give the landlord $11,057.50. That's half of $22,115. That's what you got. All right. And so the remaining $11,057.50, I agree with you that to send people checks for 10 cents or 15 cents when it costs you 45 cents to send them. So how do you want to divide the $11,000? Now, first of all, have you sent checks to all the people that you've listed here?
Except for the people that are on the bottom.
On the bottom, Mark, you haven't sent those.
And it's cost me $13 or so long.
That's fine. And so you pay all of those people, the $217 one guy's owed, $15, and so forth. Then you're still going to have
the $22,115, divide that by two, and so what do you want to do with the remaining $11,000? You want to think about it?
Can I think about it and actually do the calculation based on that?
Yeah.
And then if I can get from Mr. Merriman, okay,
So that these people can be present, you want to come back in 20 days, and everybody come back in 20 days, and you'll say, this is what I propose. All these people each get $212. One person gets $100, this person gets $58, or whatever.
Right. And if I can get, because I do not have Ms. Michael's proof of claim. I don't. So any of the ones that I have, and then the person that's...
Which Ms. Michael's? The one that, Pamela Michaels?
Yes.
Well, it was theoretically, I mean, not theoretically, literally, is the name of her mother, Ms. Morgan. I believe we introduced that.
Sarah Morgan is her mother. Okay. So this is the claim right here. Sarah Morgan for $250,000. It's filed. I've got it now. I'll make a copy and I'll hand it to you. Right?
Okay. But anybody that we have that I don't have, because, and then I need to know from the TBD, I don't know how much he's saying. This one, I think it's the Hamiltons. I don't know how much their claim is.
Who are you talking about?
This Hamilton got up. Her claim is actually scheduled.
Her name's not Hamilton's. Hammond.
If you look in on the list and...
I can't.
Okay, Ms. Hammond, you'll have to come up because my court reporter wants to hear what you're saying. Lisa Hammond. She says her proof of claim is $26,822. $26,822.
Okay, that's the amount. Okay.
$26,822. That's what you're claiming.
So that's what I'm proposing. Basically, giving the landlord half of the amount you're on, then do the calculations, and then we come back at a month and say, this is what it would be.
And one last time, if there's any claimant, including you, Mr. Merritt, or your associate there, partner, in your law firm, would y'all like to retain the services of a forensic accountant, such as Laurie Dyke, is a world famous forensic. The last case I had with her, divorce case, she charged an asset of $60,000 to do a forensic audit. You know Laurie Dyke? And I'll give you until then to say, yes, we have contacted Laurie Dyke and we want to hire her. You have no objection to them hiring her.
I don't. I've used Laurie. That's what I was saying that I've already paid Laurie.
Okay. He knows who Laurie Dyke is.
Yes.
I don't have the money, and this is what I don't mean me personally, but it's not like my board of commissioners say for people who run auction houses and steal from their clients, we have a slush fund of $3 million to hire forensic accountants to go and investigate these things. That does not exist, and you know that, Mr. Merritt. I just don't have that.
I understand, Your Honor.
Yeah.
So as I understand it at this point, the court is going to...
I'm going to let Mr. Phillips, who has proposed that the remaining $11,000 and change be divided in some manner against among the various claimants. And we'll come back on that day and he'll have a list and he'll say, I'm proposing that Sarah Morgan is actually the claimant. Sarah Morgan's going to get a check and I'm just making up a number for $550. And Miss Lisa Hammond is going to get a check for only $300 or whatever. I don't know any other way to do it.
Your Honor, is it a foregone conclusion then that the landlord is going to take precedent over the other victims?
That's what I'm proposing now. That's what he suggested I do. And the truth is, in hindsight, it would have been better just to let them file their dispossession and put all the stuff out on the street. We wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be arguing. We wouldn't spend all this time. And really, that's what should have happened. He should have just said, you should have just gone ahead and filed a dispossession on behalf of the landlord.
Yeah.
Everything would have been set out on the street, and all of the people up and down the highways, as you've seen other people dispossess apartments, the people come up and grab their stuff. And that's what happens when you're at work on the day that your house, your apartment is dispossessed. They set your furniture out by the street, and then people come driving up and grab a lamp, they grab a bed, and so forth. And I'll be glad for you to spend, or your clients can hire you to, again, hire an accountant to investigate the thing.
Your Honor, will I have an opportunity to make closing argument for the record?
Or you don't need to today.
I was just going to ask whether today or, I mean, some of these people.
Why don't you do this? Why don't we look, after he prepares this proposal as to how to divide up the $22,000,
you can come to court and say, this is preposterous. I think the landlord should only get $8,000 or $5,000 or whatever.
Well, my argument, Your Honor, was to have removed the procedure given all that's occurred. But,
I will withdraw right now, Your Honor. You signed an order, and it needs to be
I'll only landlord. Do it if you'll become the recipient.
That's right.
Your Honor, I think, with all due respect,
do you want to be the recipient?
No, I don't, Judge.
Then I can't make it. Who am I going to put in there?
I'll do it.
No.
I'm here to put my bid in for receiver.
I'm not going to do that. So if you
and I did that in the beginning, sir, with all due respect.
She's not the member of the bar. She's not the license holder. I cannot appoint her.
Yes, I am.
Yes. Now, do you want to be the receiver, Mr.
I don't, but okay. I all right. Just okay. For my client's protection and other people, if the court's telling me to make closing argument in 20 days and we see whatever Mr. Phillips comes up with, fine. But I'm stating on the record that...
You want to make a closing argument now? Fine.
I would like to, actually.
Sure. No, right. Okay, you can step down, Mr. Phillips. You want to make a closing argument?
Well, I just would like to argue some law and at this point in time, and I can preserve some more for later. If that's fine with the court, I'll be brief. I appreciate the court's time, Your Honor. I realize this is a somewhat unusual proceeding, and we appreciate the court's latitude and how things have somewhat in unorthodox fashion unfolded. However, that doesn't change the argument on behalf of my clients and, frankly, on behalf of what I've heard for potential claimants that are not mine, or claimants that are potential clients of mine. Whether they go with me or not is immaterial for purposes of my comments here today. The whole purpose of a receivership judge, you're well aware as a Superior Court judge, and doing this a lot, is to protect an account for assets in a given case where they are appointed receiver. And the fact of the matter here, Judge, is that under OCGA 9-8-2, the receivership statute, that equity may appoint receivers to take possession of and protect trust or joint property and funds whenever the danger of destruction or loss should require such interference. I can't think of a more classic case for why this statute was enacted than what we're dealing with here. Mr. Phillips has gotten up and offered no explanation for why he repeatedly violated the March 15, 2016 order of Judge Krieger, ran roughshod of it, frankly, where he was ordered in paragraph 4 to perform an accounting. I read this and I'll read it again. Of all inventory, merchandise, products, assets, or things of value in the possession, custody, or control of any party in which L.R. Barnes and/or Four Seasons has an interest, to perform an evaluation of the inventory, ensure that any liquidation, sale, or disposition of the inventory takes place in a commercially reasonable manner so as to maximize the value and profitability of L.R. Barnes and/or Four Seasons. I don't see in there at all any language allowing all shucks, let's shrug our shoulders, the money ain't there. He's offered no accountability. No accounting. He doesn't remember that, you know, who was there, who wasn't there. It's apparently in his version of receivership, the burden is on all these folks, most of whom did submit a proof of claim at some point. It was accepted by the court and made its way to him. He didn't do his report within 60 days, pursuant to paragraph 8. He violated paragraph 24 of the order. And that leads us to OCGA 9-8-3, Your Honor, says the terms on which a receiver is appointed shall be in the discretion of the court. Judge Krieger entered an order that is binding. Pursuant to this statute, the discretion of that judge set forth that order, and he failed to follow it. He violated the law. Section 9-8-8. The receiver, subsection B, the receiver shall discharge his trust according to the orders and decrees of the court appointed. He is at all times subject to its orders and may be brought to account or removed at his pleasure. And I'm curious, Your Honor, 9-8-11 states the liability of the receiver where the bank fails. Now, I understand this section has to do with FDIC and other provisions to protect funds with legitimate banks. I find it incredibly curious and bizarre, as a practical matter, as a 37-year member of the bar, that he would run this stuff through his trust account. Why wasn't a separate account set up? That's not hard to do. We do it all the time for estate matters and other things such as this. because he didn't care. He was going to do it however he wanted to do it. He didn't follow the orders of the court. We have no reliable, objective documentation by which to test anything he said here today. And I realize I'm coming in late in the game, and that's nobody's fault. Had I been here earlier, maybe things would be different, maybe not. But the fact of the matter is, you have five people who hired me, you have six or seven other people who took time out of the day to come here, and they're all saying the same exact thing. This is not a conspiracy. This is not them getting together to pick on Mr. Phillips. They're all here because they were mistreated and the process has let them down. And the fact of the matter is, we have an estate that we've heard is between $3,090,000 by Mr. Phillips' estimation. And we've heard 3.5, and we've heard a higher number from Ms. Michaels, I understand. And now we're down to less than 30,000, half of which gets to go to the landlord and let him stay there. What about all these people? They didn't get their property back. A few of them got paid. Most receiverships, Judge, deal with the same issue. They can't afford a high-class accounting. They can't afford, ideally, what we would want if we had the ability to go every single document. But the reality is, the money went somewhere. And of course, Mr. White isn't here, nor ever will be, to offer his insight. And that's a tragedy in and of itself, I understand. But the fact of the matter is, all of these people are left holding the bag because of his inactions. And Mr. Phillips was very precisely and capably put in a position as somebody who represented Mr. White, knew his business, and he could have been a real asset. And instead, I'm not even sure what happened here. We've got a website that he knows really very little about that had a hodgepodge of information. He takes that and combines it with where he got other sources of information. And we throw it into a database that we haven't even seen or hasn't been produced to the court. But we're just supposed to accept it. There's no testing. Forget about there not being any money. We don't have the ability to actually analyze this information. It's not there. It's just, well, I did the best I could. Well, he had to rely on something. He was able to get notices to some of the people. He seems to remember some of the folks who had submitted claims and who we talked to, but not others. He had a database he should be compelled to provide. And I think it's totally within the court's discretion, according to the statutes I've cited and what we all understand.
He did not file a motion to compel, so I don't know why you're arguing that. But
it's within the court's discretion, Your Honor. It's not a discovery dispute. It's a...
He's been paid a total of $894 for all of this.
And I'm not sure what he did. Nobody else here.
He made an accurate accounting, Mr. Barrett. He really did. He did the best he could, given the limited resources. But go ahead.
Well, Your Honor, all due respect.
One more time, I'll appoint you as the receiver if you want it. If you don't want it. And you don't have another lawyer to appoint either.
I don't.
No, and I don't have the power to compel somebody to work for free. That's not appropriate, and I'm not going to go pick out some lawyer and say, you've got to do this. And he has made an accounting, and so once again, I've offered you the opportunity, if your clients want to hire an accountant to go and review the books and review everything that Mr. Phillips has done, now please do that. All of his books are open for you to go and review. He's not hiding anything.
Well, had I been involved with the case earlier in time, would provided a certain would have done that, or I would stand here and complain about that now, and I will take the court up on that opportunity before next court day. Perhaps that will
allay your
further flesh suspicion. Out.
Allay your client's suspicions that somehow Mr. Phillips is lined his pockets with money. He's not. I understand what really happened here, which is that Mr. White cheated these people. Mr. White was a thief, a scoundrel, and a crook, and so I'm sorry that that's what happened, and he killed himself.
Well, subject to that, Your Honor, for purposes of the record where we are procedurally, I'll reserve the rest of my closing for the appropriate time.
And in the meantime, if you can find somebody who would like to step in, because he's more than happy to turn over the responsibility to some other lawyer. And if you can find somebody that will be willing to serve as the receiver, I'll be glad to do that. Again, I'll appoint you. And last but not least, if y'all do want to hire a forensic accountant to go in and do some investigation, you certainly can. And there's not any money left.
They don't have any money because of the waste that has occurred, obviously. And there's I'll reserve my closing argument, but for the record, we will avail ourselves of the opportunity to inspect any books, databases, electronic paper data, whatever he has, and we would ask in open court on the record if he please preserve those items and make himself available, because 20 days or whatever is not a big turnaround with our schedules.
No, we'll give you longer than that. You're going to have a hearing 30 days from now?
Whatever pleases the court.
I'm trying to please you, I'm trying to make you feel comfortable on behalf of your clients that nobody has stolen money other than the dead man. Other than the dead man did steal money. But Mr. Phillips.
Well, let's just make it 30 days then. Since some of these folks are out of town and they need some more folks and they get retained by others to give everybody a fair shot to work with me and try to figure this out.
How do we handle the fact that there is going to be, I'm not asking for compensation from you, Your Honor.
I know it.
But there is some, she's been here all day today, too.
I agree. And so she's going to submit her invoice, and we'll take that up at the next hearing. Go ahead and bill your hourly rate, whatever it is.
All right, that's all I have. Thank you. At this time.
Now, why don't we go ahead and get Matt to do an order setting it down for a hearing. When is it, honey?
We can either do December the 16th.
December the 15th.
The 16th is the Friday.
Excuse me, December the 16th.
On the 23rd.
On the 23rd. Right before?
16th.
Christmas. You want to do the
16th?
16th.
Friday the
16th. I think, a little farther away from Christmas thing, you get that for everybody. So the 16th is fine by us.
All right, December the 16th. Your lawyer is representing him. He's speaking for you. I think when Mr. Phillips said he did not have this proof of claim from Sarah Morgan, for some reason, the one I was filing.
I'm just saying I didn't have it for today, so therefore I didn't have it.
Oh, okay. She had a copy of it, which you filed today in open court. Okay, there you go.
Your Honor, just to clarify, nothing will be dispersed until the next hearing. Is that correct?
Nothing will be dispersed.
I'm not dispersing anything. I'm an order from you. So.
All right. Nothing will be dispersed. Correct. So.
For the benefit of those interns. Thank you, Judge.
Chris is doing an order for y'all, and she'll bring it in just a second. But this is my copy right there.
Thank you.
For 4 hours.
Okay, appreciate it.
And then they start.
make sure.
Yes.
Normally, a receivership, a bankruptcy, you have to pay rent going forward. So even if they miss a rent payment 2 days after they filed or receiver, he doesn't say that. But this order was different because of that. So we're not asking for preferential treatment as a credit order. We're not even claiming repetition. It's not a post-petition. So that's where the difference is. They have a specific good in the order. Because this was a liquidation.
Maybe I don't understand what you're saying. It was just quite possible. I was feeling wrong. But so you're saying there's a rent post his appointment as a receiver?
Right. And from March 15th to June 15th.
But when did he die?
February 25th or 6th.
So you're charging rent to the auction house. You're charging rent to
the business.
The business.
Right, because it was still in there. That's.
But he was
there was property still in there?
Right. He was 180 something.
He was well behind before he could have
that. Right. What happened was they actually were going to dispossess the company. Actually sent.
Oh, but in that case, if you do it like you do, like an apartment complex does, if you empty all of the belongings on the street, it's their stuff, right?
Right.
That should have been a warehouse at that time.
Right. And if that had happened, just like the judge said, all that stuff just would have been.
If that had been happening 18 months ago, I wouldn't even know it's still listing. Like, woohoo! Well, so why didn't they get him out when he was late? Like, if I don't pay my rent, they kick me out.
Right. Well,
they don't go, you got 18 months, you better pay that rent.
Well, because we have landlords that actually have a soft spot